This is the NFL. It's a dogfight every week.
There's one word, man. That's win.
Average people don't get this far in life. This is your chance to do something special.
Champions don't hesitate. They slow.
Leave a little bit of yourself on this field today.
Gotta go to work. Gotta go to work. Gotta go to work. Gotta go to work.
Half a league. Half a league. Half a league onward. All in the Valley of Death rode the 600.
Led by Mark Brunell and Jimmy Smith, the Jacksonville Jaguars rode bravely into the season, intending to dominate all the National Football League. The most successful expansion team in the history of sports was, as it began its sixth season, finally ready to win it all.
We did come into this season with high expectations.
There's not to make reply. There's not to reason why. There's but to do or die. Into the Valley of Death rode the 600.
And then it all began to crumble. Just two wins in six games. Now, three consecutive defeats. One more frustrating and inexplicable than the previous.
We're just not clicking right now. We're just not executing.
And so they arrived here for a blood feud against the Tennessee Titans, just hoping to win a game and resurrect the season.
We are 2-4. We need a win real bad.
Cannon to right of them. Cannon to left of them. Volleyed and thundered. Stormed at with shot and shell. Into the jaws of death, into the mouth of hell, rode the 600.
The cannons are named McNair, George, Bishop, Hurst, and Godfrey. And they have turned Nashville into the mouth of hell for all who trespass.
This is a must win for us.
That's how you gain your confidence back, by going to Philadelphia Stadium and beating the Tennessee Titans.
We've got to win, and we've got to start winning right now.
As it was for the Light Brigade in Tennessee's classic home, tonight it's do or die for the Jaguars when they face the Titans on ABC's Monday Night Football.
Are you ready for some football? Here the pass, thunder, and a lightning strike. Storming the field, sparks will fly tonight. We're charged and ready. The crowd goes berserk. It's a wake up call. Time to go to work. You better get ready. It's going to get rough. Because Monday Night Football is powerful stuff.
A very special night in Nashville, Tennessee. Monday Night Football has come to town, and the Tennessee Titans are ready to go out onto the field at the Adelphia Coliseum, where the crowd never goes home unhappy. They played 10 regular season games here, one playoff game. They've won every one of them. I'm Al Michaels. Welcome to Nashville, and you don't have to hit the Jaguars over the head with a board. This, as we said at the top, is a make-or-break game for a team that's been to the AFC Championship game twice in their five-year history. But if they start 2-5 and they're underdogs tonight, Tom Coughlin knows all too well teams that start 2-5 almost never get to the playoffs. The Titans, meanwhile, began the season coming off their Super Bowl appearance by losing on opening night to Buffalo 16-13. But since then, they've played very well on both sides of the ball. They've won four in a row, and of all things, might have to guard against looking past Jacksonville tonight and to two upcoming road games at Baltimore and Washington. So Monday Night Football comes to Music City, USA. To talk about something like that than Hall of Fame quarterback Dan Fouts. What did you think about what went on last Sunday night?
Well, it had to be tough for Mark Brunell. He told me it was the first time in his football life he's ever been pulled out of a game. Tom Coughlin said he didn't like all those fumbles. He didn't like all those interceptions. So Brunell and his teammates have got to rally together tonight to beat the Titans. And the Titans are going to make life miserable for Brunell. Jeff Fisher told me that because Javon Kearse only has 1.5 sacks so far this year, he's going to turn the freak loose. Watch for Javon Kearse to line up all over the field tonight, including a great matchup with Tony Boselli. Four in a row now for the Titans over the Jags, and now, like you said, they just don't lose here.
They don't lose, and one of the reasons they don't, they have a great running game led by Eddie George. And I know you agree with me, Dan. Very few people remind me more of Eric Dickerson than Eddie George. What do you think, Eric?
I think so. I tell you what, Eddie George had a typical Eddie George year. He started off slow. He had 300 yards in the last two football games. Now, one reason he did that is because he slowed down his steps and had a chance to let his offensive linemen make the blocks. Now, the Titans are what I call a smash-mouth football team. They don't do anything fancy. How does Jacksonville stop this? They have to get penetration in the backfield to cause some type of disruption. If not, it'll be a long night for the Jacksonville Jaguars.
And the Jacksonville Jaguars don't need any more long nights. Melissa Stark, what's your take on what's going on with the Jaguars?
Well, Al, you mentioned that Tom Coughlin pulled Mark Brunell in the fourth quarter last week. Well, on Monday, Coughlin hesitated about who his starting quarterback would be this week. It took him 4 hours to decide. That didn't sit well with Brunell. That didn't sit well with his teammates. They think that Brunell's being unfairly blamed for this. They looked to the offensive line, which has given up 27 sacks. They looked to Fred Taylor, who's not the same player that he was before his knee injury. Bottom line is, nothing would help the Jaguars get back on track more, Al, than a win tonight.
And that's exactly what they need. Well, Dennis, Tom Coughlin under some pressure, a little bit of heat for the first time since he took over the Jaguars.
Yeah, it's hit the fan in Jacksonville, Al, and everybody's got their theory on how Coughlin's going to handle it. Seems the local citizenry assumes he's going to become Captain Bly, start keelhauling any presumed malcontent. The local press has gotten even more paranoid. They think of him as Captain Quig, hallucinating that there are strawberries missing from the team's walk-in cooler. But I met with him on Sunday, and the guy's much more like Captain Kirk. He's genial, he's alert, sitting upright at the captain's chair, ready to do battle with his personal Klingons, the Tennessee Titans. And why not take the beleaguered route this year? After all, they were 14-2 last year, but their two losses were to Tennessee. Why not limp in at 2-4? Right now, they're wounded, and they're very dangerous. And any Michelin guide approved Buana will tell you the one time you do not want to cross paths with a Jaguar is when it's hurt. Al?
I know one thing, Dennis. Mark Brunell hopes he won't be Captain Hook for the second week in a row tonight. Good one. As Mark Brunell, Fred Taylor and company, and the Jaguars take on Jeff Fisher and the AFC champion Tennessee Titans.
ABC Sports welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
Beautiful night here in the state capital of Tennessee, Nashville. There is the capital itself. Monday Night Football, first regular season Monday night game here. We had a preseason game, the Titans against the Rams, back in August. 74 degrees, overcast today. Crowd really into it. Sold out, of course. Close to 68,000 looking on. Jeff Fisher took over as the head coach of the Houston Oilers in 1994. In fact, he made his debut as the Oilers/Titans head coach on Monday Night Football after Jack Pardee was fired in 94. That's Steve Lindsay, who will be doing the kicking off for the Jaguars. Their other place kicker, Mike Hollis, who has been inactive, is active tonight. He'll be kicking the field goals, taken at the goal line by Derek Mason. Mason, dangerous return man, brings it all the way back out to the 36-yard line. Tripped up by Brant Boyer as we meet the Titan backs and receivers.
Steve McNair, quarterback, Alcorn State.
Eddie George, running back, Ohio State University.
Lorenzo Neal, fullback, Fresno State University.
Derek Mason, wide receiver, Michigan State University.
I'm Chris Sanders, a wide receiver from The Ohio State University.
Frank Wycheck, tight end, Maryland.
I think all those Buckeyes will now take a page out of that book last week with Robert Smith and Chris Carter, The Ohio State.
Yeah, that loss to The University of Michigan, Minnesota.
Yes, they did, in Columbus. A little screen is set up, and it's errantly thrown by McNair, who is backpedaling. Second down. Let's meet the offensive front for Tennessee.
Brad Hopkins, offensive line, University of Illinois.
Fred Miller, offensive tackle, Baylor University.
Bruce Matthews, guard, USC.
Benji Olson, right guard, University of Washington.
Kevin Long, center, Florida State.
And you'll note there is Bruce Matthews. There was some question as to whether he could perpetuate his streak of starts and games played, which goes back well over a decade with a sprained knee, but he's in there tonight. And Eddie George has carried the ball 71 times in the last two games, up to the 39. Let's take a look at the Jacksonville defensive line and linebackers.
Renaldo Wynn, defensive end, Notre Dame.
Tony Brackens, defensive end, University of Texas.
Gary Walker, defensive tackle, Auburn.
Seth Payne, defensive tackle, Cornell University.
Lonnie March, Sam linebacker, Tulane University.
T.J. Slaughter, linebacker, University of Southern Mississippi.
Kevin Hardy, linebacker, University of Illinois.
Defense did a good job for the Jags last week. It was the offense that cost them the game with six turnovers. Third and seven, McNair, who can take off with the best of them, finally throws as he comes close to crossing the line of scrimmage, and it's incomplete, intended for Frank Wycheck.
I thought Matthews might come out in a Willis Reed uniform tonight. The guy is tough as nails. When I heard he couldn't do further damage and it was just about handling the pain, well, you knew he was going to be there to punch in.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting that Jeff Fisher said it would be Bruce's decision. He worked out before the game. Fisher feels he could trust Bruce. He's been around him for so long that Bruce would have the team's best interests in mind. It's good to have him in there.
Tonight, the 203rd consecutive start of the 38-year-old Matthews' career. Craig Hendrick to punt. R.J. Soward, the rookie from Southern California, their number one draft choice, gets taken down up at the 19-yard line. Tackled by Keith Bullock, who was the Titans' first-round draft choice. So one rich young rookie tackles the other, and here comes Brunell and the Jacksonville offense.
Mark Brunell, quarterback, Washington.
Fred Taylor, running back, University of Florida.
Damon Sheldon, fullback, Sacramento State.
Jimmy Smith, wide receiver, Jackson State Tigers.
Keenan McCardell, wide receiver, University of Nevada, Las Vegas.
Kyle Brady, tight end, Penn State University.
And they begin. The Jaguars from their own 18-yard line. The crowd is already deafening, and Jimmy Smith makes the catch. He's had some huge days against the Titans.
This is 47 catches on the year now for Jimmy Smith. He and Keenan McCardell just setting all kinds of records. The two of them with over almost 100 catches already on the year combined. Great way to start the game with a 9-yard gain to set up a very tempting second down and short for Brunell and this pass offense.
McCardell's got 49, Smith now with 47.
And they rank 1-2 in the league. The crowd, as I mentioned, so deafening that you actually have movement up front before the snap. The pass is incomplete.
Nothing like this when we were here in exhibition season.
No way.
This is vibrating my solar plexus, Al. I'm hyperventilating. CPR me.
I think I'll just ear hole you. That'll snap you out of it.
It was so noisy. Bernie Kukar is the referee. As we look at the hit on Brunell after he gets rid of it, but there was no flag. Third and one from the 27. Taylor is the tailback. Shulkin is the fullback. Taylor gets the give and doesn't get the first down.
You can really give credit to this crowd here at Adelphia Coliseum for those last two plays. Coughlin's not going to like it, but the matchup that we've been wanting to be watching tonight is Javon Kearse moving along the line. Here he is, number 90, working against Kyle Brady. And the thing about the crowd is that on second down, it forced Brunell to throw the ball away, and on that down, the Titans were just too quick off the line of scrimmage.
Brian Barker, who has never had a punt block, picks a low liner, fielded at the 32 by Derek Mason, and he brings it back to the 40, where the Titans will begin their second possession of the night. So Monday Night Football comes to Tennessee. 2:34 into the game, nothing. Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Nissan Driven. Budweiser with a crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. Visa, the preferred card of the NFL. Visa, it's everywhere NFL fans want to be. And United Airlines, helping people stay united. Home of the Grand Ole Opry, Nashville, Tennessee, celebrating the 75th anniversary This weekend, big weekend in Nashville as Eddie George begins his second Tennessee drive. 1 yard up to the 40-yard line. Now let's take a look at the Jacksonville secondary tonight.
Emmanuel Bryant, corner, University of Alabama.
Aaron Beasley, cornerback, West Virginia University.
Donovan Darius, strong safety, Syracuse University.
Mike Logan, safety, West Virginia University.
One thing Aaron Beasley does very well is blitz a lot. In fact, Beasley has 4 sacks on corner blitzes in the last 2 games. Second down, 10 is, it's a little swing. Eddie George, Brackens is out in space to knock him down up at the 48-yard line. It'll be third down and 2.
That's one of those cases where Tony Brackens is a defensive end, and I'm sure Steve McNair would love to see him out in space covering Eddie George on pass routes instead of coming at him on the pass rush. But Brackens is the best in the league at dropping back and reading the quarterback's eyes. Got a controversial play last week against Baltimore where many people thought he put the ball in the end zone, or at least should have had the ball down on the 1 yard line, but Baltimore got the ball off the penalty.
Turned out to be the biggest play in the game. Third down and 2 at the 48-yard line. Double slot to the right, and McNair on third and short had the man open. It was Derek Mason who got free, and he overthrows him. He had beaten the rookie corner, Kiwaki Thomas.
And what he did is he gave a great slant move. It was a double move, really sold the post route, got Kiwaki Thomas to fight on it. Here it is, top of the screen. Look at this move right there. That's all that he needed with his speed. And McNair is going to be just kicking himself and throwing that ball 1 yard too far.
That's beyond biting. He's going to need orthodontia work.
Craig Hendrick to punt. R.J. Soward will let it bounce at the 20-yard line.
The R is for rookie.
He's been playing like a rookie. And we have a hold here. Bernie Kukar signals a hole against Jeff Fisher's Titans. And now the question becomes, do the Jaguars want the Titans to punt again, or do they take the ball at the 17-yard line?
Holding. 50, offense. A 10-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Terry Killens, and they'll make them punt again.
Terry Killens is lined up right here. Watch him reach out with his left hand. Jaguars trying to overload this side with 3-on-2. Killens reaches out and grabs Donovan Darius. Not a real smooth start for the Titans.
It is fourth down. Soward backing up now, standing at the 20-yard line. High snap. He comes down with it. And a high floating kick is fair caught at the 18. So it's a wash. That's where they would have had it had they declined the penalty. But Hendrick adds 5 yards to his punting average, or at least gross.
And cumulative.
Well, football gives you a great reason to stay home Mondays. Now, two guys and a girl, the reason to stay home Fridays. Two guys and a girl. Dendu, I do a cameo on this show this Friday night.
Yeah, well, you want to get some ratings on that show, make it two girls and a guy.
Good point. First down at the 18-yard line.
Must menage television.
Here's a draw. Fred Taylor. And yeah. Taylor with his best run of the season by far. Only one guy to beat. And getting the angle on him was Samari Roll and knocked him down at the 13-yard line. So Taylor, who missed some action earlier in the season with a sprained knee, had carried 46 times, had not broken one more than 13. This is 71.
He told me that this is his favorite play. It's called the bounce play. The tackle and the tight end block down. The onside guard pulls. Taylor follows the fullback to the outside, where then he uses his instincts and this breakaway speed to either cut a back against the grain or go all the way down the sideline.
Here's Keenan McCardell laying a key block on that play as well to spring him.
Your back's against the wall. You run Taylor behind Baselli 20 to 30 times tonight.
First and 10 at the 11. Taylor comes out and they put Chiron Stiff in. He's the rookie and he gets banged down after a gain of 3. A rookie from Virginia Tech. So Taylor needing a blow after a 71-yard gain comes out for the moment. It'll be second and 7.
And the Titans
Spartan defense last week against Cincinnati gave up one big running play to Corey Dillon. It was an 80-yard run, very similar to that long one by Fred Taylor.
This is what the Jaguars needed. They're thoroughly engaged now.
Second and six, and I have a feeling that Kirst may have been offside. Just a feeling.
Kirst went across the international date line on that one.
Yeah, no neutral zone there.
Well,
we got a couple time zones.
Offside, 90 defense, unabated towards the quarterback. That's the 5-yard penalty. Correction, half the distance to the goal, second down.
Anytime Kukar whips out the word unabated, you know you've got a serious penalty.
You talk about scary. Scary is Javon Kirst unabated.
That's the biggest thing that I've noticed about the league. In the old days, Javon Kirst would have been able to keep on going and plant Mark Brunell on the turf.
Well, Kirst only has 1.5 sacks. Boy, he must be chomping at the bit.
And look at this. Jacksonville dead. Well, they're third from last in the league. Six touchdowns and 21 trips to the red zone. Second and two.
And that's inexplicable.
And this is Taylor, and he picks up the first down, so they'll move the chains. First and goal.
I was going to say that's inexplicable with a quarterback as mobile as Mark Brunell. I just think this team had to be... Listen, this trough had to come eventually. You just cannot be 14-2 as an as a expansion team in your fifth year. So they had to have this coming, and I think it's woke them up. Indeed, I think they have been to your hold.
Actually, they have spotted the ball shy of the 1-yard line. It looked from here as if he easily had the first down. It's going to be third down and inches from inside the two. It's a big spot, as it turns out, because Henry Ford breaks through for the tackle.
Henry Ford, aptly a solid assembly line player. Big pressure.
And Fred Taylor couldn't get the inches necessary, so instead of going for 7, he'll have to settle for 3 on a 23-yard field goal attempt by Mike Hollis, who's missed the past couple of weeks with a back injury.
Looking at the most accurate kicker in NFL history here, folks. Kicks away!
And that is good.
It's away and good, isn't it?
That's the little thing Hollis does every time he kicks. He lets you know it's away. And thank you.
3-0 Jacksonville, but they can't be happy.
State at Michigan, or other regional action. Saturday on ABC.
Remember, all you kids at home, never pick your own zits.
I guess we're back. And it's the Dolphins against the Jets next Monday night. A beauty on Monday Night Football. We'll be at the Meadowlands. That's the battle for first place in the AFC East. Lions-Bucks Thursday night on ESPN. 3-0 Jacksonville as Derek Mason fields Lindsey's kick. Out past the 30, into Jaguar territory, all the way to the 37-yard line.
Not much chance there, Al. 183 straight games. They haven't had a return all the way. But pretty good effort by Mason to break that streak.
Alan Lowry, the mastermind of home run throwback, the Titans special teams coach, and that's a very special teams guy, Derek Mason.
He's one of the best in the league. He's got an average of over 30 yards. Now, this will really help it. But you got to look at the play by Jason Kraft of the Jaguars, number 29. He and Lindsey keep Mason out of the end zone. Mason's looking for help from Perry Phoenix, get a block on Kraft. But Kraft cuts him off, turns him back to the inside, where Lindsey makes the tackle. Great play by the Jaguars, keeping a great return out of the end zone.
Eric Morris shaken up, injury timeout. We are back in Nashville. That time of year, Monday night, first regular season game ever played. In Tennessee is McNair on first down, hits Mason, who just made that run back 66 yards to put them in prime position. Takes it to the 19, first down.
Dano, nobody is within mouths of Steve McNair. And I noticed that the Jacksonville Jaguars only have 13 sacks after six games this year. What's up with his own
blitz? Well, you can see it right there, Dennis. A little play action pass, but I think a lot of teams are getting used to the scheme of Dom Capers' zone blitzes where he drops the defensive lineman out. Steve McNair said the key is to read it before the ball is snapped and make sure you got the line going the right direction.
For a three-yard loss. We should mention Mason has become a bigger part of the offense because Kevin Dyson is gone for the season with a knee injury. Carl Pickens is inactive again tonight. They expect him back next week. And Yancey Thigpen's been hurt, and he's limited tonight.
It's amazing. You know, you talk about, check out Tony Bracken's number 90 right here. Frank Wycheck with a good job of pushing him into Eddie George, but Brackens does not make the tackle, but he certainly has a lot of help as he turns George back to the inside.
You only see that very infrequently, boys. George being tackled behind the line. Only 7% of his carries last year. Tough to stop him back there.
Best in the league in terms of percentage, and here he is. And he gets those 4 yards back, so he's back to the original line of scrimmage, which is the 19, stopped by Ronaldo Wynn, only 3rd and 10.
Eddie's like a fleet Georgie Chavallo or Carl Mildenberger. He just works the body, man. In the fourth quarter, they don't even want to come up on him. He hits so hard.
Georgie Chavallo.
The young Georgie Chavallo.
That was Chavallo.
Huh? Well, we called him Chavallo because we were Star Wars fans. It's like Chewbacca.
3rd and 10 at the 19-yard line. Thigpen is in the game. Yancey's missed 2 weeks with a hamstring pull. McNair. Wycheck, his favorite target. And Wycheck inside the 5, takes it to the 2.
Year in, year out. You bring Pickens in. You got Thigpen. Year in, year out. Wycheck leads the team 4 years in a row. He's doing it again this year.
Well-designed play. It's going to be a big screen out to George, and then to the inside comes Wycheck. He gets some nice help down the field. Benji Olsen. A little bit of a slow block on Ronaldo Wynn, but this is well-designed by Mike Heimerdinger. Kevin Long out in front. Now they're inside the 5.
Jags are just thankful it wasn't Aaron Kinney coming down there.
On 1st and goal, Eddie George gets taken down. Nice play by Darius coming up from the secondary. One reason I think Wycheck is so dangerous, not only tonight, but in every game, but particularly tonight as they go without a huddle, is the absence of Hardy Nickerson, the linebacker. Here is McNair throwing off balance, and that is juggled and then caught by Wycheck. Exasperated because he winds up with the defensive end, Ronaldo Wynn, covering Wycheck.
Yeah, and this is another case where maybe teams are catching on to the Dom Capers style of defense, but no style of defense can stop an effort that Frank Wycheck gave his quarterback on this play. Watch as he stays with it and grabs it when it hits his body.
That is an unbelievable thing.
Al Del Greco. Through, so Wycheck takes them down to the 2. Then after Eddie George is stopped, it's Wycheck again as they go without a huddle to take the lead. Steve McNair. Wycheck has been his favorite target for the last 4 seasons. Wycheck has led the team in receptions, is leading again this year, caught 2 on that drive, and this pick is fielded by Reggie Barlow, who takes it from the 2 up to the 22.
Let's take a look at that great, well-executed tight end screen from the ump cam. Great fake to the outside to Eddie George, and then look at how wide open Wycheck is. 2 catches on the drive for 21 yards. This one got him down. And here's the touchdown. Look at this effort by Wycheck. Great coverage by Ronaldo Wynn. And just a better catch by Wycheck.
Yeah, Ronaldo did a pretty nice job for him.
Really did.
From the 22, Brunell to throw on first down. Pump fakes, sacked stopped at the 16, Eddie Robinson.
You know, they're getting to Brunell around 4.5 times a game this year, and as mobile as he is, that's unbelievable. When you think about losing Searcy, you've got a rookie, Brad Meester, in there. They've got some O-line troubles down here.
Well, and Fred Taylor does a terrible job of trying to pick up a blitzing linebacker. Fred looking down at his fallen quarterback, and this just fires up the Titans. Eddie Robinson doesn't get a whole lot of sacks. That's just 1.5 on the year. But he is the most important and most intelligent guy on this defense.
Second and 15. 28th time that Brunell has been sacked in this, their 7th game of the season. And Freddie Taylor takes it up to the 23-yard line. Let's meet the offensive line for the Jaguars.
Tony Baselli, offensive tackle, University of Southern California.
Zach Wiegert, offensive tackle, Nebraska.
Brad Meester, offensive guard, Northern Iowa.
Dennis Miller, fledgling announcer, University of HBO.
Brendan Stye, offensive guard, University of Nebraska.
Jeff Smith, center, University of Tennessee.
Well, like I said, they're hurt.
Dan, I think I just identified the problem up front.
Yeah. Well, I feel sorry for Mark Burnett. Now they've got it.
Too many men in the huddle.
12 men in the huddle.
He caught me.
That's a too many men on the field penalty.
He caught me.
12 men on the field.
I was only out there for a millisecond.
And 6 offensive linemen, or 5.5 out there, I think.
So Tom Coughlin, not only the head coach, but in effect the offensive coordinator. Jaguars are one of only 2 teams, the other is Washington, that doesn't have at least somebody designated as the offensive coordinator. Some teams have OCs, but the head coach still calls the plays. These teams don't even have offensive coordinators.
Well, Coughlin says it's not the play calling, it's the execution, and he's going to stay in there.
Third down and 13, a low snap to Brunell in the shotgun. He gets it away and is caught by R.J. Sowers, but not even close to a first down, as he's back only close to the original line of scrimmage, and they're forced to punt.
But for the Jaguars, you've got to look at the positive side on that play, and I'm sure Coughlin's not. Brunell made a great catch of a terrible snap, and R.J. Sowers, number 81, caught a pass. He dropped 3 last week against Baltimore. In fact, he's dropped 5 on the year, and that was his 6th catch of the year. Not much out of a first-round draft pick.
Now Brian Barker. Good, deep, angle kick. A real beauty. Fielded by Mason back at the 17. Great move by Derek. And a good run back after a 61-yard kick that pinned him to the sideline. Mason still comes back. Good run back. There's a flag down, a penalty marker down to the 28-yard line.
You know, Barker's never had one blocked, never returned for a TD, and here's the eerie thing. He's never had a punt come down.
As a Jaguar.
Illegal block in the back. 25 of the return team during the run back. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Albino, what do you mean as a Jaguar? You shot holes in my logic there. I thought it was never.
I had mentioned it before, but Brian has been around for a lot of years. He was with a couple of other teams before he was a Jaguar.
Yeah, he had one punt come down in his rookie year.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
All right, Dino, you got me there.
From the 18-yard line on first down, this is Eddie George.
Oh.
Up to the 29-yard line, tackled by Darius.
You know, there are just no soft spots on Eddie George's body to make a tackle, especially when you're a defensive back. You weigh 215 pounds like Donovan Darius, and you've got this machine coming at you. Running behind Bruce Matthews, number 74, right there. Watch as he gets a nice double team with Kevin Long. Comes off on the linebacker. This is a guy that is 39 years old. Bruce Matthews, been all pro at center, guard, and tackle, and playing on a bum knee. What a great play by a great Hall of Famer.
And he's looking for a second block on each play.
And his brother, Clay, a great linebacker for years with Cleveland. Bruce is very proud of Clay. Clay is now the freshman coach at Agoura Hills High School in Southern California. And he says they're winning games by an average of 23 points.
I bet they're tough. I bet they're shutting them out, too, the way Clay used to play defense.
How would you like to go up to Clay Matthews and tell him you got a sprained ankle? How would you like that look?
Second and 1 from the 28-yard line. 41.
It's like one of Michelangelo's statues in Nikes.
Well, and he just embarrassed the young rookie, T.J. Slaughter, third-round pick out of Southern Mississippi. Watch 53 right here. He's going to jump on George's back, he thinks. Gone. Oh. And it takes two little tiny defensive backs to bring down big Eddie George.
Eddie George starring in the Eric Dickerson story.
He does, doesn't it?
Amazing.
Look at Eddie's old school, no logo on that hat there.
First down at the 41-yard line. Sideline. All the way inside the 35, marked out at the 33.
Like it's not hard enough to tackle him inside. Let's get him outside and free him up to run a little.
Gotta love the way the Titans' offensive game plan is working. Time to throw for McNair, finding his outlet. Pretty good looking outlet, too. Eddie George come real close to stepping out of bounds on this play. Gets down the sidelines.
You know, it's funny, we saw Donovan Darius come on up on him a little early and take him head on. And it's just the attrition. Darius comes up there and it's just want to take a more shallow angle on him.
And that is the way the first quarter comes to an end. The Jaguars took the early lead. But now after one, it's 7-3. The Tennessee Titans on top. And Monday Night Football is back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. As we come back to start the second quarter at the Adelphia Coliseum, we still may go back to the first quarter because Tom Coughlin has now challenged the mark where Eddie George goes out of bounds.
I think it's going to be about a 15-yard difference because George did go out of bounds. In fact, he went out of bounds twice, once with his right leg right there, and then on down the field with his left leg right there. So he is out of bounds, and he got about 10 yards after 10 yards extra.
So Coughlin is hoping that the ball will wind up back at about the, I'm guessing, 47-yard line. We'll have to take another look at it. But at the, for the moment, they've marked it at the Jacksonville 32. Bernie Kukar in the hood.
I bet that phrase is the first time that's ever been put together. I'm not sure Bernie goes to the hood often, do you, Jeff?
Eddie George on this drive has been the whole drive. Rushing and receiving, and he has carried the ball, as I mentioned before, 71 times over the past 2 weeks. Last week against Cincinnati, 36 carries. The Titans controlled the ball more than 40 minutes, and they were trailing at the half in Cincy, but came back to win the game mainly thanks to that man.
Now, Cincinnati is really a franchise in disarray. They took Akili Smith out for a while last week. They brought in Red Klotz from the Washington Generals.
How'd he do?
Huh?
How'd he do?
Held his own.
As only Red can do.
So Tom Coughlin, during the break between the first and second quarter, and the guys upstairs, of course, are the ones, the assistant coaches, who will call down and say that needs to be looked at again. So we had plenty of time to decide whether this was worth a challenge, which, of course, if it's not upheld, costs you a timeout.
So I guess I'm the only one in America who's willing to trade off a little imperfection in some of these calls for not stopping down like this in the middle of a...
And it really doesn't seem all that important, but for Coughlin and the Jaguars, every yard is important. They're really questioning whether the heel ever went out of bounds there. I think it did, and I think that this challenge will be upheld.
Well, let's bring in coroner Cyril Wecht to go over the tape for me. Come on.
After reviewing the play, the runner stepped out of bounds at the 40-yard line. First and 10 at the 40. There is no charge timeout for Jacksonville.
Okay, so for Tom Coughlin, it's worth 8 yards.
All right.
It's worth 8 yards, and the only other thing it costs him is one challenge. Remember, it's one thing that's very often overlooked. You're allowed to challenge 2 plays per game.
And it was the second foot that they ruled went out of bounds. They did not think that heel touched down there. gave Eddie George a couple extra yards, all for that. Huh,
not enough pictorial evidence to overturn, I assume, Dick.
I assume.
Huh? I go from a football game, all of a sudden I'm in a forensics course.
Well, these well-rested units now.
Eddie George has another year in on the pension since that play started.
Seems like it. First down at the 40-yard line, and they give it to him again. Happening through the middle, but then he spins and picks up another half yard or so. Seth Payne makes the tackle.
This is exactly the type of game the Titans want. Control the ball on the ground, take time off the clock. The last 2 weeks, they've just been phenomenal with their time of possession. In fact, they lead the NFL in time of possession thanks to those two games against the Giants and Cincinnati when they went over 40 minutes per game. Bad sign for the Jags if Jimmy Smith is not feeling good.
Well, they say that Tennessee's been winning ugly, but that beats losing pretty any day of the week.
Here, here.
There it is, the first team since Bill Parcells' Giants in the 90s. Back-to-back games with over 40 minutes of possession time. As it's dropped, Eddie George started to turn and look upfield and drops it.
Incomplete. Intended for Eddie George.
The third down.
And McNair was under a little bit of pressure as he had to step up in the pocket. You see Slaughter coming on the control blitz. Eddie George lets him go because Kevin Long has got him. Ball thrown just a little bit behind George, but George has got to make that catch.
You know, Eddie had a slow start this season, but they said they worked on his footwork a little. Now he's coming around. I find it hard to believe it was all footwork. The way he bludgeons people, that's like putting a sharper point on a nuclear weapon.
Like a piano concerto, each team with 88 yards this far. 7-3 Titans here in the Music City. On third down and 8, McNair throws. It is caught by, who else? Rychek. And his main man, McNair's main man, takes it to the 22.
It's always been the knock on Steve McNair as he doesn't read pass defenses very well. But check out Rychek here on the crossing route. And he's all alone. How can you leave the leading receiver on your opponent all alone in the secondary?
Well, all you can ask out of your offensive coordinator is to have him guessing. And our friend Mr. Heimerdinger certainly has that going on tonight.
I'll tell you what, they have got a couple things going. Their toughness and now the smartness of this game plan.
Back to George, and that's a nice tackle by Kevin Hardy, the left outside linebacker. Kevin Hardy, fifth year out of Illinois. He was their number one pick in 96.
Has no sacks this year, Al. Now that and the Tony Banks throwing 5 touchdown passes show me that this defense is somehow falling into serious disarray.
Well, last week the defense did a good enough job to win the game for them against Baltimore. The offense is what really killed them, and Hardy with more room to roam tonight, especially as I mentioned before, Hardy Nickerson, the middle linebacker, is out. Second down and 10. Back there. Wobbler over the middle, nearly picked off. Derek Mason, the intended receiver, and Aaron Beasley got his hands on it.
And actually what happened when the ball came in there, it was Mason who was playing defensive back. Ball's a little bit wobbly there. That might have been reason that Beasley could jump to the inside on Mason. But Mason made sure that Beasley did not intercept this pass. The great play. Good look at the read by Beasley and the speed to get in front of Mason on the in route.
Aaron Beasley, a lot of corner blitzing from that guy. We said before, 4 sacks in the last 2 weeks. No other Jaguar has a sack in the last 3 games. Third and 10. McNair to the end zone, and it's the floater shoveled and caught by Mason. Unbelievable catch. The Rams may be the greatest show on earth, but these guys are a circus. 2 touchdowns on 2 juggling catches. One by Rychek, this one by Mason.
Yeah, well, the Jaguars ostensibly should be the hungrier team tonight, but Tennessee is really going for the ball. Rychek, now Mason.
Well, when you're hot, you're hot. That's just a great job of Mason staying with it. And George putting the ball beyond Jason Kraft, number 29. Look at the concentration. Hit off his face mask, and now it's bouncing on the back of Kraft's helmet. Eddie George will be buying dinner for Mason and Rychek after those 2 catches.
Well, you can't fault Kraft or Wind on either of those. Just great plays by the Tennessee receivers.
Some of
the folks around the Titans were talking about Mason being as valuable as anybody on this team thus far this season.
Well, he's already had a 66-yard kickoff return that set him up nicely for their first touchdown drive.
And Mason is hurt. That is the reason we have the delay before the conversion, as Mason is still down in the end zone.
Check it out right up here. Ball thrown to the outside. I think Mason wanted it to the inside. And he is being pulled. He really only caught the ball with his left hand. Looks pretty good there, but now they're checking out his legs.
Well, he got up right after the catch. Maybe a cramp.
Maybe a scene from Jerry Maguire.
Yeah. Were you in that movie too, Al?
Your work was beautiful in that movie.
But I won the Oscar for basketball, as you guys all know. Conversion coming up, 13-3 Tennessee. We're still waiting for the conversion attempt here. And we'll take a look at the touchdown again. We'll also show you Mason, who was assisted off the field. And here comes Del Greco's extra point attempt after the 22-yard touchdown. And that is good. But Tennessee has an 11-point lead, but serious problems in wideout right now. Here's the touchdown.
And keep your eye on his right ankle here. And watch, Kraft is going to fall right on the back of it, right there. And he got up, walked off the field limping badly on that right leg. You got to marvel at this catch. He has it. Now he doesn't have it. His eyes are always on it, though. See how big his eyes got? Reaches out with his left hand, bounces it off of Kraft's helmet, and makes the catch.
And actually,
really
the ankle looked like it was hurt at the precise moment he had to pull it in. So he really had...
To the music of Ricky Skaggs, we can tell you Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Ford Outfitters. No boundaries. Ameritrade. It's how you get somewhere on Wall Street. Budweiser with a crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. And Dell providing the infrastructure to power your e-business. Now, we talked about Mason out for the moment. We'll get a report on him. Carl Pickens is already inactive tonight as they work on Mason. Yancey Thigpen is coming back from an injury. Kevin Dyson, as we said before, is gone for the year with a knee injury. Also, it's a double whammy with Mason. He is their kickoff return guy. To the one-yard line, Chiron Stiff. And the rookie brings it back to the 24, where he's taken down by Keith Bullock, the number one draft choice. Keith Bullock picked in the first round out of Syracuse.
Well, they got to get Yancey Thigpen back on the field. He's only played 25 of 40 games since he came to Tennessee, and one of those was not the Super Bowl. Probably need him right now.
You know, you asked the question, are you ready for some football? Well, I'm asking you, are you ready for Bashir Yamini and Chris Coleman? They may be the wide receivers for the Titans tonight.
Meanwhile, the Jaguars at the 24-yard line, they have Alvis Whitted in the game at wideout, along with McCardell and not Jimmy Smith. And a flag is thrown. Brunell was looking to call a timeout.
Ball start. 77 offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
That's Wiegert lined up over Javon Kearse. Let's meet the Titan line of linebackers.
Javon Kearse, defensive end, University of Florida.
Kenny Holmes, defensive end, University of Miami, Florida.
John Thornton, defensive tackle, West Virginia University.
Jason Fish, tackle, Stanford University.
Greg Favors, linebacker, Mississippi State.
Eddie Robinson, outside linebacker, Alabama State University.
Randall Godfrey, middle linebacker, University of Georgia.
First and 15, and the crowd is so noisy that Brunell, who was going to call a timeout before the last play, now actually has to call one. 12:31 left in the half, and Tennessee in control right now. Bye. And we're back as the Jacksonville Jaguars just had to burn a timeout as they begin this drive at the 19-yard line. It's first and 15 for a team that must win tonight, that is now down by 11 after taking the early lead. And Mark Brunell is minus Jimmy Smith in the lineup at the moment, and it goes down in the arms of John Thornton. And Dan, I don't think it's premature to start talking about what took place at the end last week and what could take place tonight.
Well, if Mark Brunell doesn't get better pass protection than this, he may be wanting Tom Coughlin to pull him out of the game. He didn't like it last week against Baltimore, still felt he had a chance to lead the team to a win. But the crowd is into it now, and the Jaguars, by calling timeouts, have been able to fire up the Titans' defensive line. They are fresh.
Second and 23, and Jimmy Smith again is on the sideline. Caught a pass on the first offensive play of the game, nothing since, and Taylor gets taken down. So on second and 23, that's Randall Godfrey. Eric, what do you know about Jimmy Smith?
Well, Jimmy Smith was behind me a minute ago riding a bike, trying to keep warm. The trainer said that he has a bruised knee, and if not sure if he will come back in the game tonight, they say they're going to see how he feels. So back to you guys.
More bad news for Coughlin. There is Jimmy Smith.
Consider the dogs officially let out.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. They are barking. Third down, 25 from the 9-yard line. Play clock is down to three. It's an inside handoff. It goes to Anthony Johnson. Veteran running back, been around a long time with several teams, picked up after the start of the season. And the Jags reduced to running that play on third and long. Let's go to Melissa.
Now, the last thing the Titans needed was another injured wide receiver. Derek Mason has an injured right ankle. His return is questionable.
And that, of course, hurts them, as I mentioned before, not only in the receiving department, but in the run back department.
Well, that might be the only area they're hurting in, because they're just teeing off on this team right now.
Here comes Brian Barker to punt. And they've got Yancey Thigpen and Marcus Robertson both back deep. And that's a bad punt off the side of Barker's foot. And that'll give Tennessee the ball, probably in Jacksonville territory, when they finish marking it off at the 43. Well, we talked to Tom Coughlin yesterday as he reflected on his decision to yank Brunell last week.
I felt at that point in the game we needed a momentum change. I felt we had had a couple of interceptions. I didn't know what the mentality of that whole situation was. I just felt like at that particular point in time that we needed to make a change to see if we couldn't spark something at that point in the game. That's why we did it.
And there is Brunell with Bob Petrino, the quarterback's coach, going over things on the sideline. First down.
Well, one thing Coughlin has going for him is that Brunell's a coach's kid, and he handled it like a man.
He did. McNair throws wide open, making the catch is Yancey Thigpen. So with Mason shelled right now, Yancey comes back. They wanted him to only see spot duty tonight. They'll probably not have to see more.
And that's a real problem, though, for Yancey, coming off a hamstring problem. You know, they said maybe 8 to 10 plays. Now he's got to play wide receiver in every situation. And as you said, Al, he's going to be back deep on the punt return. We'll see how Yancey Thigpen does on a bad hammy.
Well, you mentioned Bashir Yamini and Chris Coleman. Certainly, if his hamstring's hurt, you got to go to one of the kids.
First and 10 at the 26-yard line. Thigpen threw a great block.
Yeah, he really did, Al. He came in and sealed the corner for Eddie George. Yancey Thigpen just stuck his nose right in there and freed George down the sidelines. Watch from the right side of the screen, right there on Donovan Darius, the safety. You don't want this man in the open field. Logan comes over and just grabs on for the ride.
You can just see the way the Titans carry themselves in this game. They believe they own Jacksonville. There's winning four in a row against the team, and then there's really believing deep down that you're on a team.
71 offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
That is Fred Miller. Eddie George. Look at the carries per season. He's been a horse since 1996. And he'd have 435 carries this season at this particular pace. And there's a guy who started the first game of his rookie season. He was the Heisman winner, of course, at Ohio State. And hasn't been on the lineup ever.
You don't want him to get 435 touches.
on first and goal, taking it to the 8-yard line.
This offensive line does a great job of staying on their feet. Mike Munchak, the offensive line coach, a great lineman for the Houston Oilers, really has them very mobile up front. And what they do is they just keep their bodies in front of the defensive line and Eddie George, and George gets inside. We talked about his footwork, Dennis. The part of that footwork part is the patience that he has now to let the linemen do their work and find the little crack.
So George in the red zone is tough. McNair in the red zone had the first pass he ever threw in the red zone, intercepted, and none since. Second and goal from the 8. McNair. Flag down. Flag at the 11.
It would appear to be against Tennessee for holding.
Holding. 74 offense. 10-yard penalty. Still second down.
They got the old man, Bruce Matthews. He knows all the tricks in the game. Let's check it out. In his 18th year out of USC, Bruce Matthews, here he is, number 74. He's got his left hand working against Larry Smith there.
You know, Bruce has been around so long, when they used to call that on him in his rookie season, it wasn't even holding. It was called grappling.
38-year-old, you would think, future Hall of Famer. Second down and goal at the 18-yard line. Out of the shotgun. And there again, and that's a good tackle, saving what would have been a pretty good game. That's Gary Walker, who of course started his career as a Titan. In fact, he was an Oiler before the team moved here. And now a mainstay in the interior for Jacksonville.
Well, any port in a storm, maybe Jacksonville can work off that holding penalty. They get a stop here, or even a three, they're still breathing.
Right in the middle is Gary Walker. Had a big game last week against the Ravens. He fights through two men to make this play. That's a great play by Gary Walker.
You sense Walker might be one of the guys chomping at the bit down there.
Benji Olsen and Kevin Long couldn't hold him.
With Coughlin's tough tutelage, because he keeps saying they have to play looser.
Third and goal, and they give it to Eddie George. And Eddie George breaking tackles, but he can only get to the 8-yard line. On third and goal, Mike Logan makes the tackle. So Fisher figuring Eddie could run it all the way in, he can only get to the 8.
He's so intimidating.
You know, it's like old Jim Brown footage.
It really is. If people who love this part of the game have got to love Eddie George. Because he gives every effort. Plus, he's so big and strong.
Now Al Del Greco for a 26-yard field goal attempt.
Hey, don't let me go!
Del Greco, 17th year in the league. And that one is just inside the upright. So they gave up the touchdown on the holding call. Have to settle for 3. Small victory for Jacksonville. They'll take any they can find. 17-3. Goodyear Tire is providing the aerial views tonight. A look down into the Adelphia Coliseum, which was built for this franchise. They came from Houston. In 1997, you'll recall they spent the first year in Memphis at the Liberty Bowl, the second year here, the crosstown at Vanderbilt Stadium, and then into their new playpen last season, where they've never lost.
Two great facilities in this town, Al. We went over and saw a Predator game the other night. They've got a nice hockey arena, too.
A lot of fun at the Gaylord Entertainment Center. That is dropped to the goal line by Chiron Stitt, the rookie. And then he brings it back out to the 25, where he's tackled by Chris Coleman, and there's a flag down and a skirmish at the 40-yard line.
I think that was unnecessary skirmish, Al.
Unnecessary skirmishing. Personal foul against the Titans.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness. 57 of the kicking team will add 15 yards to the end of the run. First down.
When you are a rookie fifth-round choice from Boston College and your name is Frank Chamberlain, you might hear something from Jeff Fisher.
And this wasn't the penalty.
Now that's an Arthur Murray class.
There is Chamberlain, who has assessed the personal foul call to take Jacksonville to the 39-yard line, first down. Tyrone Smith is the running back with Taylor on the bench. Brunell nearly has that one picked off by Samari Roll.
You know, it's amazing to think of Curse with only 1.5 sacks, but you take some of these rookies who have over 10 in their first year, like Haley Boulware, Simeon Rice, O'Neal, all the guys who know how to rush the passer, and it seems like they get onto them in the offseason.
And the Jaguars just 2 yards through the air tonight, 118 for the Titans. Brunell has only thrown the ball 4 times. Second and 10 from the 39. A lobbly pass, it is caught up at the 44-yard line by Alvis Whitted. Let's go to Eric Dickerson.
Well, Al, I tell you, when everything's going bad, everything's going bad. On the sideline here, Donovan is having an argument with his defensive back coach. I don't know what they're talking about. All I know is saying you're not blitzing from the right area. So for the Jacksonville Jaguars, everything seems to be going pretty bad right now.
Well, it's Donovan Darius having an argument. Jimmy Smith is not in the game. They're working on Fred Taylor as well. And Brunell throws, and that is caught by McCardell, who moves the chains, taking it to the 42-yard line, tackled by Blaine Bishop. That's his first catch of the night.
When in trouble, go to the leading receiver in the league.
And what they did is they finally got a favorable matchup in the secondary for McCardell. It's man-to-man because the Titans are coming on a blitz, trying to get Brunell down again. But the heads-up play by McCardell, getting extra yards after the catch.
First and 10 at the 42-yard line. A swing pass caught by Alvis Whitted, who fumbles. And at the 34-yard line, the Titans get it. And there are flags as Brady gets into it with Greg Favors.
Well, boys, when it turns ugly on you, it turns really ugly in the National Football League.
Especially on the road, especially when you're making mistakes. Bernie Kukar wanted to know what happened from the other officials. But Whitted gets hit by Blaine Bishop and coughs up the ball. The quick pass out to Whitted on the outside, never puts the ball away. Now Bishop comes up with the tackle, and then the ball's popped loose by two Titans. And there's Robinson on the ball.
Eddie Robinson recovers it. Tom Coughlin just exasperated at this point. 6 turnovers last week.
Sonny might have to adopt a personal zen here. Bless is more. You got to encourage these guys right now. Everybody else is
35-yard line. First and 10. Here is Eddie George. No gain. Tom Coughlin, and it's an amazing thing when you think about it. He took over an expansion team in 95, but he has always stressed what the coaches call ball security. And when you look at all of the coaches in the National Football League, the history of the league, there it is. A lot of that is indicative of the fact there are fewer turnovers, of course, in the modern era than there were in earlier years, because Fossil is second and Switzer is third. All fairly contemporary coaches there. But just 1.5 per game.
Why were there more fumbles way back then? Could the ground cause a fumble back in the Gerskys' day?
Good point. Second and 11. Here's McNair. And that's caught by Wycheck, and then Wycheck barrels up to the 41-yard line. Flag comes in at the end of this play. One reason, Dennis, they threw a lot more interceptions in those days.
Yes, we did.
Dano.
But not one of those 242 is my fault. Okay, I just want to set that straight.
Unnecessary roughness
71 offense. The 15-yard penalty, still second down.
Were you ever tempted to hang around and go for 250?
I think I am now. Fred Miller, 71, is going to get this penalty. Whitecheck's got the ball. He's struggling for yards down the field. Watch Big Fred take off now. He's going to try and get a shot on the guy he's been working against all that time. That's Rob Meyer.
Come on, that's Kevin Gogan 101.
I'm not sure that's really unnecessary roughness. That's kind of like football.
He's cleaning up the fringes of the pile.
Yep.
Second down and 19. Eddie George up to the 36-yard line. Setting up a third and 9. Three and a half to go in the half. Tennessee trying to make it 5 in a row, and the Jaguars trying to avoid a 4-game losing streak.
Bruce Matthews and this offensive line really controlling things, protecting McNair. He yet to be sacked today. And here he is, 74, working against Rinaldo Bryant and just taking him down to the ground. Rinaldo Wynn, rather.
Third and 9. Whitecheck is the man in motion.
The cavalry is here in the form of Yancey Thigpen. Talk about injured wideouts. This has got to look great to Jeff Fisher.
He also has got to love the throw by McNair, clearly across the field to Yancey Thigpen. He lined up as a receiver on the far side of the field, came all the way to the inside with a great fake there, and then cuts all the way to the outside. That ball was in the air about 70 yards.
What a tough team Fisher's put together. You can tell he's a Buddy Fisher or a Buddy Ryan acolyte.
From the 27-yard line, McNair tried to jam it into George and knocked away by Kevin Hardy. 2:04 remaining in the first half.
Great play by Kevin Hardy, looking for his first interception of the year. Had good coverage on Eddie George. This is the type of effort that the Jags defense gave Tom Coughlin last week against Baltimore. But this is not the Baltimore offense. This has got Eddie George and Steve McNair and Whitecheck. They're all working hard.
I like that little music there. A little audio sorbet.
Getting us ready for the 2-minute warning. Eddie George fumbles the ball. The fourth straight game that George has fumbled, and it's recovered by Larry Smith. It's the fourth game he has fumbled. It's the third game in a row he's lost a fumble. He fumbled into the end zone at Cincinnati last week, and this is the one thing that can keep Jacksonville in this game.
Well, they're going to have to take advantage of this turnover. This is just a dropped handoff by George. It looked like he was looking for a place to run and just dropped the ball, and Larry Smith was there to get it.
2-minute warning. Promotion right there. Since the hit, remember the Titans?
I know, and you see the kid had put Will in green and a red arrow pointing to it. I think it was code. I think he was saying hi to his friend Will. I think he just saved himself a quarter on a phone call.
Jacksonville trying to save something at this particular point after the fumble. That pass was tipped. There's also a flag down. Ball is a holding call against the Jaguars. Bernie Kukar will tell us.
77 offense. 10-yard penalty, still first down.
Zach Wiegert, he's had his hands full tonight. One reason is because coming up on the Toyota Halftime Show, we have the guy across from Zach, that man, Javon Kearse.
We can go bowling. It ain't like before. Got a resolution. This year I'm playing a ride.
Video and audio mic'd up at the half. Here's Brunell now in first and 20. Slings it downfield and has to throw it away. So here's Brunell under pressure, banged up offensive line, minus his top receiver, Jimmy Smith. And for the moment, Fred Taylor is on the sideline. They were working on his hand earlier.
And
And then they get the turnover unexpectedly from Eddie George just dropping the ball. And the first play, they have a holding penalty. So instead of moving down here at the end of the first half, they're moving backwards.
They're just rope-a-doping here, man. They got to get it into the barn, a little Gatorade, and figure this one out.
1:47 to the half. Second and 20 from the 19-yard line. Dumped off to Anthony Johnson underneath, and Anthony Johnson into Titan territory and out of bounds at the 25-yard line. Anthony Johnson is anything but a big play guy, but they picked him up as a third down specialist. He's been with Indy, the Jets, Chicago, and Carolina, and was out of work at the beginning of the season.
This is his first catch of the year. Let's give the play caller, Tom Coughlin, some credit for coming up with a perfect call against this defense. It's a four-man rush. Everybody else was dropping deep, and Johnson takes advantage of it. And now the Jags have a shot at getting something here at the end of the first half.
That's amazing mental toughness by the Jags. If they can get free here, we still got a game.
From the 33, after Brunell's first pass of 20 or more yards in three games, that one is tipped, but lines up in the hands of Brady, who makes his first catch and takes it to the 28-yard line. Tipped by Greg Favors.
I think even the football gods thought it was getting too brutal there. They're dropping the Jags a couple favors there. A tip pass.
Great job by Greg Favors tipping that ball, and an equally great job of catching it by Brady.
Second and four, low snap, fielded by Brunell over the middle, finds the open man. That is Johnson, who takes it to the 21, and that is a first down. And Brunell wants to save his timeouts here. Jacksonville has two remaining. With under a minute, Brunell, and his miscommunication on that pattern, as Whitted broke off the pattern at about the 10.
Well, the other part of that, Al, is that Randall Godfrey was coming clear on Brunell, and he just didn't have enough time. If he has another millisecond, he might have been able to get the ball to Whitted, but Godfrey, with a lot of speed from his middle linebacker spot, came around the corner right in the face of the quarterback.
You don't expect
here he is,
here.
Right here. Watch him come. And that's why Brunell had to get rid of it high.
Whitted, Anthony Johnson, these are not names you expect to hear at this point.
Second down and 10 from the 21-yard line. Brunell for the end zone, and it's thrown out of the end zone. Good coverage on the play. Denard Walker had Whitted blanketed.
And right here in this type of situation, I would like to see Brunell get out of the pocket. Right now, the Titans know where he's going to be. They're kind of zeroing in on that 8 to 10 yards behind the line of scrimmage. With his mobility and the chance of running the ball, this is four down territory. If he picks up five here, they got a shot at, and I got to believe they got to go for a touchdown, not settle for that field goal.
Third down and 10.
The Tennessee mindset, we're going to smack in the face till we're not allowed to smack in the face anymore. That was the last nanosecond.
Lane Bishop with a big hit, pops it loose. McCardell was flying for the end zone. Another bad break.
Keenan McCardell has been in the league for 9 seasons. It's only the third fumble of his career. He was just, well, it's like the coaches say, you got to make a play. You're looking for somebody to make a play, and he tried to make the play by doing it himself. Smelled the end zone. Blaine Bishop was there. And Tom Coughlin will go back into the locker room with his team down by 14.
He's got to like this effort, though. McCardell is wide open. Kind of inexcusable by the Titans, but watch this effort here to get in the end zone. Marcus Robertson and Blaine Bishop, the big hitting safeties of the Titans, make the play.
And Samari Rowe recovers it. Let's go to Eric.
Coach, you seem to have the same problem you had last week with the turnovers.
Well, we had a turnover there at the wrong point in time, and of course right now we drive the ball down. We can't take advantage of that score. We've had breakdowns on kickoff coverage. We had a poor punt. We haven't had the best of field position. We're battling and we're fighting. They're a tough team to stop. We got to stop in the second half. We talk about turning the ball over. That was an attempt to make a great play. We just didn't secure the ball. It got hit right on the ball and the ball came out.
Thank you, Coach. All right, over to Melissa.
All right, Eric, Eddie, you guys are controlling the ball again, but if it's not you, it's Frank Wycheck, Derek Mason, or Yancey Thigpen. Is there any way to stop you guys?
Well, we just want to keep moving the ball, just keep trying to execute our offense. You know, we have to eliminate our mistakes. You know, we're killing ourselves right now. Especially with the fumble and penalties, so we're going to try to take it up the second half.
Killing yourselves, you're up 17-3.
Well, you know, this game is 60 minutes, you know, and anything can happen. As you've seen just now, you know, the score can be 17-10. So we have to come out, execute, figure out what our mistakes are, and come out ready to go.
Thanks, Eddie.
Right.
Take it away.
So that is the first half here. Coming up, the Toyota Halftime Show. Javon Kurse mic'd up. Closer look at Aaron Beasley and a look ahead to next week's battle in the AFC East. 17-3, Tennessee. The Toyota Halftime Show brought to you by Toyota. More choices, better selection. Experience Toyota today. Pretty crazy ending to the first half, dominated by Tennessee. The Jaguars had a great chance to get right back in it and cough up the fumble at the end of the half, 17-3. Well, one of the great draft picks was last year when Floyd Reese, the general manager of the Tennessee Titans, with the 16th pick in the first round, picked the kid out of Florida, Javon Kurse, who had an unbelievable rookie season. We have Javon mic'd up at the half.
All right. We can go bowling. It ain't like before. Got a resolution. This year I plan to buy. Woo! What you got for me? I'm no longer a Monday night version. No longer. Gotta save a little bit for the game, man.
Yeah, you get some water in you.
Yeah.
Shut it down. Wash got you guys ready. Good game plan. We're ready to roll.
Yeah.
You just gonna do what you do, baby.
Got to.
Thank you tonight.
My first one, man.
Jeff Fisher told me that because Javon Kurse only has 1.5 sacks so far this year, he's gonna turn the freak loose.
Samari rolled and knocked him down.
Oh, man. Man. Hey, I caught a crackback so nasty on that one. Hey, Fish, who that was cracked me? I wonder who it was. I got to know who it was, though. Who it was, 87.
Here's McNair throwing off balance, and that is juggled, and then
what?
Javon Kurse and his unit, they've held the Jags to 3 points. Meanwhile, Wycheck caught that touchdown pass. Mason caught that one, and it's 17-3 at the half. Tennessee seeking its fifth win in a row. Jacksonville trying to avoid its fourth loss in a row. 17-3 in this AFC Central battle. And next week, a battle for first place in the AFC East. And the big surprise is it doesn't feature Indianapolis. It will be the Jets, who yesterday went to New England against the Dolphins. And it was Bill Belichick against the Jets. But it was Curtis Martin who got the day off to a good start for New York. And then it was Martin taking it in for a touchdown. And how about Mo Lewis? He tips that Bledsoe pass, which Glenn runs in for a score. Then Lewis, of all things, lines up in the backfield on a fourth down play and runs for a first down. And Mo Lewis then winds up sacking Bledsoe, one of seven given up by the Patriots. Martin has scored there, and they're 5-1. Meanwhile, Jay Fiedler has led the Miami Dolphins to a 5-1 mark, due mainly to the great work by their defensive unit. Dave Wonsett has his team at 5-1, so it's the Jets and the Dolphins, first place in the AFC East, at stake next week on Monday Night Football. Meanwhile, let's take a look at one of the great corners in the NFL, Aaron Beasley, right now, as we go to Dan Fouts. Dan?
Well, thank you. Aaron Beasley, coming into the game, has been the real spark plug for the Jaguars. We're just going to check him out on a couple of passes. Makes that play on Frank Wycheck, and then this outstanding play against Derek Mason in the red zone. Steve McNair's had a good first half for the Titans. 10 out of 16, 162 yards, and great effort from Frank Wycheck on that four-yarder there. And then Derek Mason gets behind Jason Kraft for this touchdown reception. And the Tennessee defense has done a good job of holding down the Jaguars. Jaguars have 83 yards rushing, but 71 came of it on Fred Taylor's run. He's out of the game now, and the pressure is now firmly on Mark Brunell, and the Titan defense knows about it. They've sacked him twice, and even this great effort by Keenan McCardell couldn't get the Jaguars to score.
Well, maybe anybody can play quarterback and win here in Tennessee. It's been that sort of season thus far. Second half coming up. We come now to Nashville, Tennessee. The first half belonging to the Tennessee Titans. Jeff Fisher's team coming in having won four in a row. The Jaguars trying to get on track. Tough half for Mark Brunell. Anthony Johnson trying to get Jacksonville back in the game, but McCardell's fumble at the end of the first half, recovered by Tennessee, providing a 14-point cushion for the Tennessee Titans.
Amazing halftime show, Al. What'd you think of the Shania Twain Faith Hill Mudra song? I did not expect that.
Gonna watch it on DVD on the way home. Here's Hendricks' kickoff to start the second half, and it's a very short kick, fielded up at the 21-yard line by Reggie Barlow, and Barlow brings it back out to the 43-yard line.
I think the Titans saw the Ravens last week have a short kick like that, and the Ravens recovered. Barlow was very heads up making that catch and getting down the sidelines. A good field position now for the Jags. 71 of these 83 yards came on one rush by Fred Taylor. You can see the total yards now in favor of Tennessee. They'd really be in favor if they didn't have that long run. In the time of possession, the Titans are right on track, averaging 34 minutes per game.
Good news for the Jaguars is Taylor is back in the game. He didn't play in the last two series of the first half. The bad news is Jimmy Smith is still out of the game. And here is Fred Taylor. Taking it up to the 43-yard line, and that's all.
That was a heck of a move that Fred Taylor put on Keith Embry, though, to get that little bit of yardage.
Numbers for the first half. Mark Brunell, a lot of that yardage coming at the end of the half on that pass to Anthony Johnson.
And he added two there. That means that Brunell's gone down twice to this Tennessee pass rush.
McNair, a very efficient first 30 minutes. Second down and 10 from the 43-yard line. Brunell takes off, slides to a halt, flag comes in. He gets to the 48, a little short of the first down. This crew headed by the referee Bernie Kukar. Against the Titans,
This is an interesting call, because if it's illegal chuck, which was a signal there, illegal contact, there was no pass was thrown.
Yeah, that's why I'm confused by the call.
Illegal contact, 55 defense. We'll add 5 yards to the end of the run. First down.
That's interesting. I thought you had to throw the pass before for you to get an illegal contact call. But apparently not. From our umpire cam, Brunell goes right by him and then gets the slide. Here comes the flag in a little bit late. Illegal use of the hands maybe is the proper call.
I was hoping it was illegal chuck. I just love the sound of it.
At the 43-yard line. Kurt Taylor with his right hand taped. And he takes it to the 40. We mentioned he was out for two series. They were working on that right hand. Meanwhile, there goes Curse for some reason, which we, of course, will check out going back to the locker room.
I think our microphone short-circuited on.
He's done being Mike.
I thought he did a good job of controlling his emotions while he was Mike that first half. You never know about those wild defensive ends, especially when they're nicknamed the Freak.
Yeah, Warren Sapp just told us, forget that, boys. Never going to happen.
Warren, it was a good editing job. Second down and 8. I'll show you the outtakes later. From the 41-yard line, Brunell gets sacked, loses the ball, but the play is over. No fumble. Keith Embry and Javon, and Keith Embry, the first guy in there.
You got to give credit to Samari Roll on the outside in the defensive backfield. He didn't go for the pump fake that Brunell was trying to hit him with down the sideline. That allowed the pass rush to get to Brunell. There's the fake right there. And now, from behind, it is Keith Embry to bring down Brunell. But Samari Roll did an outstanding job deep down the field, not going for that little pump fake by Mark Brunell.
Brunell did a hell of a job just holding on to the ball.
Meanwhile, Embry is playing for Javon Curse. So Curse go away. Embry is a 29-year-old rookie, in effect. And that pass is incomplete. Try to jam it into Fred Taylor, and he was surrounded.
Boy, again, the Jaguars get good field position. They get a break on a strange call by the officials. And then they take a sack, and now they got to punt the ball back to the Titans. Rough way to start the second half.
Brian Barker to punt. By the way, Barker used to be going back to the first half with Kansas City and Philadelphia. That's where he had his punch blocked earlier.
I thought that was Bob Barker.
Four pelts. Fair caught by Yancey Thigpen at the 11-yard line. Early in the third. Tennessee by 14. Big weekend here in Nashville. Mentioned before that the Grand Ole Opry celebrated its 75th anniversary.
You know, Garth did an album under a completely alias, a fictional character named Phil Bengston.
I recall. From the 11-yard line, Eddie George goes nowhere on the Titans' first offensive play of the half. Melissa, what do you have?
Al, you saw Javon Curse head into the locker room. He has cramps in his legs. He's a bit dehydrated, so they are giving him an IV.
Okay, that's the story on Curse.
Missy's very succinct tonight.
Yeah, that's a good report. I like that.
She's usually more extrapolative.
And they call the wind Melissa. Second down and 9 from the 12-yard line. Eddie George, like a bowling ball after the 20. Top by Donovan Darius. It'll be third down and 1.
He's like a bowling ball. He's following a bowling ball.
Look at that.
Lorenzo Neal. That's not Lorenzo. That's pretty creative. But there's Eddie George. And he's got that big fullback, 240-pound Lorenzo Neal following up.
That last inning, I got to go call my shrink.
Look at that. 88 carries and counting could eclipse the mark of Earl Campbell. McNair slides to a halt after picking up the first down over the 25-yard line. Dan, how would you carry characterize McNair as a quarterback now. Number one draft choice out of Alcorn State a few years ago, led his team to the Super Bowl.
Well, I think you start with his heart, and then you look at the way he plays the game. He is the new age quarterback. We saw it last week in Dante Culpepper, the ability to combine a great running back and a guy who can read defenses and throw the ball. And McNair right now is as good as any quarterback in the league.
You know, what I like about him when he's rushed and he does come up for air, he looks down the field first before he takes off.
From the 25-yard line on first down, McNair going deep. Out in front is Chris Sanders, who's been a big play guy his whole career, all the way to the 20-yard line, tackled by Mike Logan.
Well, you're talking about guys who have had over 100 receptions in their career. Only one has a higher per-catch average than Randy Moss, and that's that man right there, Chris Sanders, at 19 per.
He told me he runs a 4-2, and here's a good example of it. Gets behind Mike Logan there, and now is working his way down the field, 55 yards on the play. But it's all set up because the Titans are so good running the ball, they get man-to-man coverage on the corner, and you can use that great speed.
His first catch of the night. It's a big one. The ball is at the 21-yard line. The play clock is down to zero. They get it off, and Eddie George fights his way for a gain of two. Well, the Jaguars have a lot of injuries, but the Titans will tell you, hey, we don't want to hear about those injuries. And Jeff Fisher is right. They're minus Kevin Dyson of home run throwback fame. Carl Pickens, who they picked up from Cincinnati, is hurt. They lost Derek Mason in the first half. And then they go deep, deep, deep and wind up with a guy like Sanders.
And basically right now they're playing with two tight end formations, a lot, and two running backs. So they have the personnel to overcome those injuries.
Second down and eight. Here's Eddie George on a slant to the outside. Inside the 10. Cuts it back. Dives to the end zone. Touchdown.
Be looking at the actual man there.
Who is going to argue?
That is the man.
Al Del Greco for the conversion. Greg Kinford puts it down. And on their first possession, with a flag down on the conversion of the second half, they'll have to try it again after a holding call. 89 yards, six plays.
And all positive plays. Moving the ball every time they got the ball, every time they snapped the ball, the chains are moving down the field.
Holding, 89 offense. That's a 10-yard penalty. Repeat the try.
Frank Wycheck with a holding call there.
I'm just throwing this out there, boys. I don't even know what it means. But Al Del Greco was born on the day the Stilts scored 100 in Hershey. Just throwing it out there.
I mentioned it to him before the game. He said he knew that. I said, how in the world do you know that? He said he saw it in the Guinness Book of World Records.
No, no. His nanny was Darrell Imhoff.
And you know, there's no film of either event.
As far as we know. This is an extra point. It's the equivalent of a 30-yard field goal.
Like run silent, run deep.
That's right. That's what happens when the umpire's mic is open. 8:48 left in the third. Tennessee by 21.
Ooh. Hello. Server? Got it.
Wow. The freak and the geek.
Well, Dendu, it's Monday night in Nashville. This is some scene. Their team up by 21. Chiron Stick.
Well, I know it's early. I'm smelling another St. Louis, Tennessee Super Bowl, though.
I wouldn't bet against it.
Is copyrighted by the NFL for the private use of our audience. Any other use of this telecast or of any pictures, descriptions, or accounts of the game without the NFL's consent is prohibited.
Monday Night Football from Nashville being brought to you by Jeep Grand Cherokee with legendary off-road capability. Compact, welcome to the new IT inspiration technology from Compact. State Farm Insurance, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of the Super Bowl. With a look at the Parthenon here in Centennial Park, replica of the one in Athens.
It's a takeout gyro sandwich joint, believe it or not.
From the 28-yard line, Brunell on first down. It is caught by R.J. Soward, the rookie from USC. Well, last week, Brunell was yanked by Coughlin, and of course was the big story in Jacksonville. Yet, it's a sign of the times, even though the Jaguars are a young team, and there is Jamie Martin, who came in to spell him last week and had one successful drive. Brunell and Coughlin are at the top of a list for success as coach quarterback combination. And this is Fred Taylor taking it up to the 40-yard line, and that is a first down.
And they really need each other. I mean, you got to have a good relationship between a head coach and a quarterback. The problem for Brunell is that he has not been leading his team on touchdown drives. You can see what they've done as a pair, but only three touchdown drives in the last 18 quarters. None in the last 2 weeks against Pittsburgh and Baltimore, and none tonight against Tennessee.
That's amazing. Brunell and Coughlin are number one. Fisher and McNair is a coach QB combination number two right now. From the 40-yard line on first down, Brunell throws, and that pass is in and out of the hands of Brady, covered by Eddie Robinson. Update now from Melissa Stark. Melissa?
Al, Tom Coughlin really made a return to the basics this week in an effort to correct the problems from last week, especially the four botched snaps. He brought a video camera to practice, and he taped the center quarterback exchanges. He said he noticed two things. One, that the laces weren't coming out right, and number two, because Jeff Smith is shorter than John Wade, the injured center that he replaced, he's lower to the ground, so Brunell really has to concentrate on getting up underneath of him. Who knows what Coughlin will videotape this week, Al?
Oh, boy. Well, here's Taylor picking up four. The one thing I've noticed tonight, Dan, is that they've had no problems when Brunell's been under center. Some of the shotgun snaps have been low.
Yeah, whenever it gets in your head that you're dropping the ball as a quarterback or the center is not delivering the ball correctly, this is some of the problems they had last week against Baltimore. Brunell said he just got to ride Smith a little bit longer, stay down there, and make sure he's got the ball.
Listen, it makes sense videotaping him, but I think Coughlin could have showed more bedside manner not doing it in front of the whole world like that.
I agree.
Third down and six. Here's Taylor, an inside handoff. Has to get to midfield and comes up a little bit short. Javon Kearse is back on the sideline. He's not in the game. Remember, he cramped up, went back in, and there he is.
Now, to be fair to Coughlin, we talked to him about it. His point was that the embarrassment happened last week with all the bumbled snaps, so he thought it was fine to do it out in the open. But I don't know, Brunell's just such a solid kid. You just want to see him treated with as much respect as possible.
Solid, and he's a three-time Pro Bowler. He's the reason that this team is a contender each year. Fred Taylor getting close to a first down. I'm sure if they don't get it, they're going to go for it on fourth.
Down by 21. They're compelled to at this particular point. 6:21 left in the third.
This is where the Jaguars have got to get the play called in the huddle, get up to the line of scrimmage, and go. The longer they hesitate at the line of scrimmage, the more the crowd will get in it and make it tougher to get this snap count heard.
There's Kearse back in, so he sees his first action now in the second half. Come up in the eye. Fourth and a short one. Taylor chugging. Did he get it? Kept those legs churning.
He needed to get to right about there. You can see where the official's foot is right there. This is going to be tight and ball. This is about 6 inches short of the first down. Again, it took a long time to get the play called. It's an off-tackle play. Marcus Robertson there. Randall Godfrey there. And Godfrey pushing him back.
gives the Titans the ball.
Well, that's all you can ask out of Freddie Taylor is to slip the Robertson tackle. Did his job.
And Blaine Bishop also got underneath to stop him short. So Coughlin has just watched his team give it back to the Titans, who lead 24-3. This Saturday, one of the best movies in recent years, Forrest Gump. 6 Oscars, Tom Hanks starring in one of the recent classics this Saturday at 8 Eastern and Pacific, 7 Central, right here on ABC.
Jags might have to suit Forrest up.
Titans have it at the 49 of Jacksonville. Play fake finds a ton of time. Open man is Eddie George. That's a first down and a 16-yard gain, run out of bounds by Donovan Darius.
Well, they dropped it off to Eddie, but his first look was way downfield, and this, we're moving into the rub it in zone, guys.
Oh, there's no question that, that Jeff Fisher is going to pile it on now. And what he got there is, again, a case where Tony Brackens was in the secondary trying to cover Eddie George. You talk about a mismatch. Brackens is a great athlete, but out in space like that, that type of defensive scheme is just not going to work, especially when you've got a coach like Fisher who has seen this scheme and understands defense as well as he does.
Eddie George, 19 carries and 3 catches tonight. Sort of like a half play for him these days. Carry number 20 is a 5-yard gain to the 29-yard line. Eddie George won the Heisman Trophy, number one choice out of the Ohio State University.
And he's the power running back in the NFL. His size and strength is such an intimidating factor for any would-be tackler. He's averaged over 30 carries the last 3 games. But his greatest improvement has been in his vision. And that allows him to be more patient to set up his blockers at the point of attack. And why the Titans are 18-1 whenever he gets more than 27 carries a game.
Cool graphic, guys. Who we got there in the animation? Ralph Bakshi?
Second and 4, and McNair has to take a timeout. The play clock timeout is all the way down
Tennessee
to 2.
That's their first charge timeout.
4:30 left in the third. Titans by 3 touchdowns. Goodyear Tires providing the aerial views tonight as you look down into the Adelphia Coliseum. On the outskirts of downtown Nashville, hard by the Cumberland River, where the Titans, in the brief history of the stadium, have not been a loser and don't appear to be tonight as well, as Eddie George on second down and 4 takes it to the 27-yard line. Coming up this Saturday on college football here on ABC, Michigan State against 16th-ranked Michigan, headlining our regional coverage. Texas A&M, Iowa State, SC Stanford, Virginia against Florida State, 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific time. Check your listings. Saturday football, college football, right here on ABC.
Duffy Doherty versus Bo Schembechler. You gotta love it, Al.
Eddie George averaging close to 5 yards a carry, and McNair under pressure. That pass is incomplete. Pressure put on by Tony Brackens.
Tony Brackett's finally getting in the face of Steve McNair, doing what he does best. There he is, number 90. Fights off the chip there and then gets help from the other side. Gary Walker in there again. And number 92, Rob Meyer.
You know, you really got to admire what Fisher's done with this team, Al. I mean, it's just amazing for a young guy to have this sort of vision. This is just a powerful, unstoppable. It's the antithesis of the St. Louis approach, but nonetheless, maybe not quite as effective, but very effective.
45-yard attempt by Del Greco, make it 44 officially, and that one is no good. And what's amazing, Dennis, is that Fisher is still the third youngest coach in the league. And he has coached this team for over 5 years. At one point tonight, as we head to New York next Monday, the Dolphins and the Jets, what a beauty that will be. At one point tonight, it was 3-0 Jacksonville. It's now 24-3 Tennessee on first down after the missed field goal. Alvis Whitten gets free. Andrew Nell overshoots him. Michael Booker fell down, covering Whitten, and it's incomplete.
That's just the type of year it's been for Mark Brunell. He gets the matchup he wants with Whitten on the outside here, working against Booker. Watch Booker get his feet crossed up. He's going to go down right there. And now this ball is going to be 2 yards too far for Alvis Whitten, who would have an easy touchdown.
Boy, Whitten has some quicks there, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Went right by him.
And Jimmy Smith has not played since early in the first quarter. Worked on his knee, pumping his way to the 40-yard line. Fred Taylor. Thunder and lightning, the at least the southern version of such.
And this catch right here, that was the first play of the game.
Right.
For the Jaguars.
Then McCardell with that one big reception at the end of the half. And if anything could have turned the game around for Jacksonville, it would have been had he gotten into the end zone. But he fumbled just before he got to the goal line. And Tennessee went to the locker room up by 14 instead of 7. And it's caught by Brady on third and 5. He has enough for the first down out to the 46-yard line.
Well, you know, the last Thunder and Lightning combo to go up against Tennessee was Ronnie Dane and Tiki Barber. They walked out of here with 1 yard between them. You see what they're doing to McCardell and Jimmy Smith. These guys are master meteorologists down here in Tennessee.
It was such a beautiful weekend, too. You know, it was about 80 degrees every day. It's just been fantastic. So, no thunder and lightning in the forecast.
First down from the 47-yard line. Taylor takes the toss. Gain of 7. Freddie gets to the 46-yard line, tackled by the ex-Cowboy Randall Godfrey.
I tell you, Fred Taylor looks good. I know he's got a bad right hand, but his legs look awful good. I talked to Zach Wiegert before the ball game, and he felt, as an offensive lineman, that they were going to have some success. You notice that he's still wearing the brace on his left knee, but he certainly isn't affected by it at all.
Second and 2 from the 46. Taylor. We talked about Tom Coughlin at the top of the show, who's come under some heat for his play calling, and here's what he had to say about it.
Tackle by Joe Salvia.
I made the decision to become the play caller a year ago. We won 15 games. I continue to be the play caller, relying on my staff as I always do. Play calling is not good right now. Why? Because we're not scoring any points, naturally. If we're scoring points and we're doing well, then the play calling is fine. Play calling is like anything else. It's continuity, it's rhythm. There hasn't been a whole lot of rhythm.
Well, the injured player is Joe Salavea. We have an injury timeout, but you recall when the Jaguars performed, Kevin Gilbride was their offensive coordinator, and he did well enough there to get hired as the head coach in San Diego, and that didn't work out. And then Chris Palmer became the play caller, and he did well enough to get the head job in Cleveland, and then Coughlin took over himself.
Here's Joe Salavea right here. Appears to be a leg injury. Yeah, well, there it is. Right ankle, maybe right knee. As one of the Jaguars rolled into him. But that's the real danger for these guys. They're struggling, trying to fight off a blocker, and then out of nowhere comes another guy and takes out their legs.
You know, Al, going back to what you said about Coughlin, when we talked to him the other day, it seemed to be losing the two coordinators to head coaching positions that led him to think maybe his quarterback needed a bit of continuity and he would take it over, so he wasn't meeting a third new guy for the in 3 years.
That factored in, and Tom, of course, his expertise is on that side of the ball. He's always been an offensive coach. And right now, his team in jeopardy of falling to 2-5. We said at the very top, 2-5 teams almost never get to the playoffs. In the decade of the 90s, as you can see in the right-hand column, only the Saints in 90 and the Lions under Wayne Fonts in 95 went to the playoffs after starting 2-5.
Shockingly, only one team's ever come back from 1-6. Believe it or not, back in 1970, the Bengals went 1-6, won their next 7 games and got in. And I think they might have been the last 7 they won, if I'm not mistaken.
It seems like it, doesn't it?
This guy is doing his homework.
Huh?
That's awesome.
Right. And just coming in for... Huh? What's on next week? Who do we got next week, Alvino?
Next week, we're going to the Meadowlands, and this is going to be... What a beauty this is going to be. It's Miami against the Jets. And we'll see your buddy Wayne Corbett again. Curtis Martin, a big day yesterday. We'll find out about Zach Thomas, whether he'll play or not next week. But Trace Armstrong and a great defensive unit as Miami takes on New York. And there it is, the standings. Miami and the Jets on top. The preseason choice, Indianapolis, 4-2. Buffalo eked one out in overtime yesterday to get back to 500. And the Pats, after starting 0-4, now 2-5.
That is the best division in football right there. None of those teams are out of it right now. I guarantee you two wildcard teams will come out of the AFC East.
Joe Saliveo walks off under his own power. The guy he's replacing, Jason Fisk, was inactive tonight. And Robert Smith is in there at defensive tackle on third and short. Brunell throws and converts. Hits McCardell, first down at the 35-yard line.
His name's Robert?
That's his name, Robert Smith.
And Robert was a defensive end at Michigan State, but they moved him inside, and now with the injury, he's going to have to play a lot. McCardell with a great move. I like the play call on third and short. This is the strength of your team right now, is Keenan McCardell working the short routes, and Brunell throwing on the run.
I think with a basic last name like Smith, he'd just go with Robert.
You can call him Roby. Good catch at the 24-yard line. Reaching up for it is Keenan McCardell.
Well, McCardell, 12th round draft pick. Not many of them left in the league since they went back to 7. And every time you look up, the kid's leading the league. I mean, it seems like they're bringing in RJ. They're always bringing in a faster guy. McCardell's always there leading the league. It's not Jimmy Smith.
He was drafted by the Washington Redskins in the 12th round. The draft, of course, now only goes 7 rounds. It's second down and 1 from the 25-yard line. Taylor fights his way for a first down on what will be the final play of the third quarter. End of 3, Tennessee 24, Jacksonville 3. And Monday Night Football returns to Nashville after this message from our ABC station. Dan Fouts, Dennis Miller, Eric Dickerson, Melissa Stark. We start the fourth quarter. 21-point lead for the Tennessee Titans. All kinds of action up front. Brunell takes off, thinking maybe it'll be a defensive call. But the whistles had blown the play dead. Zach Wieger, offensive tackle.
Ball moving. Start, 71 offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Wieger and Buscelli were both moving.
Hard to miss Buscelli, but this is Wieger. There's Buscelli. And Buscelli's going, hey, he moved over there.
That's right.
Call it on him.
A lot of face time for Kuki Kukar tonight.
Tony Buscelli. He and Orlando Pace, the only offensive lineman in the 90s, drafted either first or second. Tony, the number 2 choice, and Pace, number 1, a few years back to St. Louis. And Brunell hits R.J. Sauer at the 21-yard line.
Well, if you still had Searcy here, if you still had Wade in the lineup, if you maybe hung on to Ben Coleman, and Buscelli's completely healthy, you get the Rocket Gibraltars there, but that is not the case at all right now.
Well, Coughlin's got to be happy with this. This is the type of pass that Sauer had trouble catching last week against Baltimore. 3 catches for RJ tonight.
2nd and 9 from the 21. Brunell gets sacked at the 31-yard line by Robert Smith.
How about that? His first career sack in the NFL comes on a Monday night. All for you, Dennis.
Robert, it's some nice moves there, huh?
This is why I call him Robert.
Look at
the moves.
Stalin, man. Like he's in a French disco.
Oh, he just ran right over the top of Brad Meester, too. He deserves this little dance.
Do it, Robert.
Burnell's been sacked 4 times tonight and 31 times this season.
That dance was called the Truman Capote.
3rd and 19, and it's Fred Taylor for a 3-yard gain to the 27-yard line.
I just don't understand that call. That's such a concession call. You go up to the line of scrimmage, and the defense say, watch out for the draw, watch for the screen.
In the meantime, you have the sprinklers that have gone on.
Who let the sprinklers out? Who let the sprinklers out?
Well, this actually happened in Jacksonville. This is payback time. This happened, I believe, in the AFC Championship game last year, or maybe it was in the Miami wildcard game. In one of the games in Jacksonville, the sprinklers went on.
Yeah. Well.
Who's the gardener here?
Who's the ex-gardener here?
45-yard field goal attempt coming up for Mike Hollis.
Well, you know, they're on a timer, and they're not used to playing on Monday night.
Tight. Parker puts it down.
Kicks
Hollis'
away!
Kick is good.
That kicks away thing, that's like that guy screaming goal at the soccer game. That is beautiful.
The Andres Cantor of kicks away. 24-6, Tennessee. Brunell and the offense. Well, he has not led the team to a touchdown in 13 quarters. Jamie Martin in relief actually led them to a score last week against Baltimore as Chris Coleman runs this kick back from the 4. And the Jaguars trying to strip the football, tackle him at the 30-yard line.
Chris Coleman, number 17. Just like Keyshawn, 19. Where are these wide receiver numbers?
Meet the all.
Monday Night Football from Nashville is being brought to you by GMC. From professional grade people come professional grade trucks. Coors Light, proud partner of the John Wayne Cancer Institute and their search for a cure. Lee Dungarees, Buddy Lee tested, Buddy Lee approved. And Wendy's bacon mushroom melt. When you gotta have one, you gotta have one.
I'll take that little Buddy Lee guy.
I'll take that Wendy's bacon melt without the mushrooms.
The shrooms. Or the tomato or lettuce.
Right. And a pristine bottle of ketchup. From the 31-yard line, Steve McNair flips it back to Eddie George, and that's a nice play. Stopping it for a loss is Rob Meyer, rookie out of the University of Washington.
Now, Dan, Eddie George, so important to this team. You think this one's over? Would you still have him in?
Well, yeah, I would, because right now what you're doing is you're building not only confidence, obviously they've got that, but George is over 100 yards. He loses 4 there, so he goes back. And Fisher is going to play this one all the way to the end. Behind Eddie George, they don't have a whole lot. Rodney Thomas is his backup, but George is the man.
Lorenzo Neal's only had one carry in 21 games with the Titans.
Second and 14, and McNair to throw, and then drop by Frank Wycheck. SportsCenter with all the highlights of tonight's game, following the game on ESPN.
Those ESPN boys are rowdy this year, aren't they? Got Merrill Hoge and Joey T. A lot of aggressive talk over there this year. We might have to have a throwdown with them. Albino's George Sakiris.
Or throw up. Third and 14 at the 26. McNair hits Wycheck. And he gets popped at the 29 by Donovan Darius.
Double D.
He hit him so hard he knocked a smile on his face. Donovan Darius. Watch Wycheck, 89, coming out late.
Great looking kid.
Man, right back on his wallet.
Wycheck's thinking, forget George, why am I still in?
Double D, there he is. Fourth down is Hendrick. Sends it away, backing up. Sowers. From the 19, out past the 30. He's run out of bounds into the Titans bench. at about the 40-yard line. 11:30 remaining in the third quarter. 24-6, Tennessee. Sights and sounds of downtown Nashville, Tennessee.
That's just the angle I need on you.
Elvis Gerbeck. First down for the Jacksonville Jaguars from the 36-yard line is Brunell. Under pressure, gets sacked again. That's five sacks, and we go to Melissa.
Now Titans defensive tackle Joe Salavea sprained his right knee just before the third quarter. He is icing it now on the sidelines. They say that his return is questionable.
All right, thank you, Melissa. So Salavea is out, Fisk is out, but they had Embry come in for a sack, and now Robert Smith has been in for a sack and a half.
And poor Melissa is being swarmed by cameras down now.
Here's Taylor up to the 32-yard line.
I think she conked her noggin on that camera as we cut away. Missy's in vogue this month, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, very nice thing on this one.
Oh, I thought you meant in a general sense.
No, she's got a little story on it. Nice picture. She's a Vogue gal.
Third down and 13 from the 32.
Boom!
Alvis Whitted makes the catch at the 37, but Samari Roll is there to stop him.
Does it get any better than it gets for the Titans right now? They're just teeing off.
I'd like to go back to your comment previously. You read Vogue regularly?
Yeah. Huh?
Dan and I have canceled our subscriptions to Vogue, but we'll reinstate them now.
What? I'm a little flimsy because I read Vogue? Come on, boys.
First guy I ever worked with but reads Vogue. Ever.
You mean Brett Musburger wasn't a big Vogue guy?
Parker's punt, field it at the 9-yard line, and that's Yancey Thigpen running it back to the 17. 10:05 left in the fourth. Titans leading the Jaguars by 18. Aerial shots provided by Goodyear Tires.
Now there's the beautiful Bell South building, or as vacationers from the state of Florida to Nashville call it, the Wide Right building. Hey, have you seen that Madigan Boys? It's a great show.
It is. Have you seen it?
No, I have not. You found me out.
At the 18-yard line, the Tennessee Titans on first down with 10:05 to go. To the 35-yard line.
22.
Eddie now 115 yards, 23 carries, and that's symmetrical, 5.0 per tote.
Like they said, they just keep fouling them in the fourth period. Nobody wants a piece of them.
The big number five is for the number of times that Mark Brunell has gone down, and a big zero for Steve McNair as that offensive line is doing the job, both pass protecting and, as we just saw, run blocking. Super job that time.
Stevie McNair's QB rating always peaks in the fourth, whereas McNair's, or Brunell's, usually atrophies over the course of the game. Thanks for the long snap, Constantine.
McNair milking the clock, gives it to Eddie George, and what better way to milk the clock than to give it to number 27? Check in with Melissa.
Hall of Fame slugger Reggie Jackson may have claimed the title first, but now Eddie George is borrowing it. Mr. October, including tonight, in the 18 games that he's played in October, he's rushed for at least 100 yards in 12 of them. I talked to him before the game. He said, it's just a coincidence, being the humble guy that he is, of course. He said, that's really when the team starts to gel in October. That's why.
And they are gelling right now because they're on their way to their fifth consecutive win. Thanks to no small measure to Eddie George with 118 yards tonight. Again, McNair takes the clock all the way down. Gives it to 27. He picks up the first down to the 49 of Jacksonville. And they'll take another 40 seconds off the play clock here.
Well, you know, Tennessee they take care of their own business in their own backyard. They're 18-2 their last 20 games against AFC Central foes. It's going to be 19-2 after this one. They just don't let anybody in their own neighborhood bully them.
Frank Wycheck getting out in front there with a good block on Kevin Hardy. Zach Piller has replaced Bruce Matthews. I'm sure he's done for the night.
Well, last week when Piller came in for Matthews, he had 100 yards after Matthews left the game. So Piller's doing an admirable job filling in. You don't lose all that much except his first.
George again. And Dennis, we were talking about Jeff Fisher. Fisher was spotted very early on when Jeff quit football. He put the coaching cleats on immediately. I'll never forget, I had a conversation with John Shaw, the president of the Rams, back in 91 when they were going to replace John Robinson at the end of the year. And Shaw said to me, he said, you know, I want to recommend this guy, who was on the Rams staff at that point, to be the head coach. He says, I don't think I can sell the concept of a 31-year-old head coach to Georgia Frontier at that point. But John was ahead of the curve, and then Fisher a few years later winds up in Houston.
Well, Shaw also might have had an early whiff of him because Fisher was at USC, though. Wasn't
right. It? Second and five for the 44-yard line. And then Fisher almost wound up getting the Philadelphia job at one point, but again, he was like 33 years old.
And when he was a player with the Chicago Bears, Buddy Ryan did him a favor. He was the defensive coordinator, and Jeff was one of his defensive backs, and Buddy told him, you know, Jeff, your playing days are just about over. Why don't you come to Philadelphia with me and be my defensive back coach? And that started Jeff Fisher off on his career, and it's turning out to be a darn good one.
Imagine learning at the knee of Buddy Ryan. I mean, who has more knee-jerk reactions? You got to be quick on your feet.
Good job by Frank Wycheck, again, getting to know Kevin Hardy real well tonight as Eddie George just continues to power for yardage and picking up another first down.
We haven't seen that Aaron Kinney kid tonight as backup tight end. Is he injured? Or? Yeah,
no, he's been in on some two tight end formations. But what the Jags are doing, instead of going with three wide receivers, they're leaving Wycheck in there and Lorenzo Neal and Eddie George.
You don't want
worked
to see
pretty
that.
Well.
Yeah, you don't want to see that Kinney kid loose in the secondary. That is a truck. He's in right now.
He's in there right now. Million people watch the premiere of Gideon's Crossing. Don't miss an all-new episode of Gideon's Crossing when it returns on its regular night, Wednesday, right here on ABC.
You know, it's so apropos. You're talking about the 75th anniversary of the Grand Ole Opry. It's founded by a guy named George D. Hay. I read a great quote from him. He said, "Keep it down to earth, boys." And, you know, 75 years later, that's exactly what Jeff Fisher is doing. This is a basic meat and potato team. They tee up, they hit you, they run hard. It's, they have kept it down to earth, as Mr. Hay admonished them way back then.
Here's Eddie George carrying for the seventh consecutive play and the 100th time in the last three games. And tonight, Eddie has toted it 29 times for 148 yards.
They ought to just start direct snapping it back to Eddie.
Cut out the middleman. Derek can go home.
Timeout call by the Jags. Log on to ESPN.com. You can check out Dendu. You can listen to Terrell Davis. And at NFL.com, a profile of Frank Wycheck.
You say albino, I say albino, you say tomato.
What would your tax rate be?
39.6, which I think is Barker's punting average.
Punitive punting average. Third and a short two. Eddie George. And his 101st carry. In the last 3 weeks is a first down of the 13-yard line.
Jeff Fisher does not like the Jacksonville Jaguars.
No, he doesn't. And there it is. We mentioned before that Earl Campbell holds the record with this franchise, when, of course, it was in Houston, at 103. Rodney Hampton of the Giants, 102. And now Eddie, with two more carries, would tie Campbell's mark.
I don't think he's going to get it. You know why? Because Jeff Fisher just took him out of the game, patted him on the helmet. Yeah. Said Eddie, nice job.
Well, I know Fisher and Earl Campbell go way back.
Rodney Thomas comes into the game, first out of the 14-yard line. And He gets the football. Yeah, there is no love lost between the Titans and the Jaguars on several counts. In fact, when we talked to Jeff Fisher yesterday, he pointed out, he said that, you know, one of the things that still grates on him is the fact that the Jaguars, when they were an expansion team in 95, their first victory came at the expense of Fisher's Oilers.
I think he thought Coughlin talked a lot, didn't he?
I think he loved the way that he got that shot at the Super Bowl press conference when he talked about the fact that maybe the Titans have five home fields. They played at the Liberty Bowl, they played at Vanderbilt, they play here, and the Alltel Stadium as well.
Right, he threw that in. He was kind of kidding, but it made for some interesting little bit of a loggerhead action. I know that if we saw Coughlin at the Pro Bowl a week after the Super Bowl, and Tom was genuinely not very happy about those remarks. In fact, here is what Fisher had said at his Super Bowl press conference.
Moves. You had four home stadiums in 4 years. Do you think that's helped the team through the whole moving mess?
Well, some have said we've had five home stadiums in 4 years, if you would include Alltel Stadium in Jacksonville. But
that is a great shot.
This is Rodney Thomas.
Hey, can I show my hammer?
If I had a hammer?
Yeah, did you see this?
Where'd you get that?
Huh? For a second, I got some football action.
Here, I'll hold it up for you.
What do you got there? See, this here?
Yep.
Last time we were in, we were talking about me visiting the Sequin Mines, going to the Porter Wagner shaft.
Right.
Porter Wagner sent me this pickaxe with all these sequins all over, and I wanted to thank Porter for that. You know, Porter had his very successful syndicated radio show in 61, 67. He teamed up with a young woman named Dolly Parton, and the three of them had a lot of great years together, and I want to thank you for this, Porter. Very nice of you.
Let's see you get through the carry-on with this one.
Huh? Disney Jeffrey.
Don't forget next week, boys, we're on to the Meadowlands.
Oh,
and that's going to be that's
for
a great
first
game.
Place.
We have two great games in the next 2 weeks, Miami against the Jets, and then we're going to see these Titans again in 2 weeks at Washington. But the Jets, 5-1, beat New England yesterday. Miami had the bye week. They've watched that, taking over for Jimmy Johnson to step down. And they are 5-1.
5-1, and I think they've only given up 51 points so far this year.
That defense is awesome.
Yeah.
You talk about the new age where you get defensive linemen dropping out. Taylor's just doing a great job. And how about Trace Armstrong? One of the sack leaders in the NFL. So Vinny Testaverde is going to have his hands full against that Dolphin pass rush.
Wow, where are the sprinklers when you need them?
Armstrong with 10 sacks. Ronaldo Lynn has been shaken up, so on the field right now, and there goes Wynn back to the Jacksonville bench. So just another Jacksonville woe tonight. The Jaguars, well, Mark Brunell has been under pressure all night long, as he has been all year long, and the Tennessee Titans tonight with a total of 5 sacks.
And the Titans came into the game with just 13. So they, like a lot of teams, have gotten healthy as far as the sack stats are concerned, playing against the Jaguars.
That prorates out to Brunell being sacked 72 times this year. That'll tie Randall for the most ever.
Third down and 11 after the injury timeout. And Rodney Thomas takes the ball to the 10-yard line.
Rodney getting a little respect there.
Well,
my goodness.
Wow, they finally got one of these billboards right, I think.
That is a professional-looking sign.
Very, very professional.
What did that cost
you?
Well,
my signs always look so shaky and crayon.
They
look
do.
At you got a calligraphy.
I just happen to be a very, you know, kind of very meticulous sort of character.
Uh-oh, this kid's committing seppuku right now.
And there again.
Well, wow.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to the Adelphia Coliseum. Huh? Nashville, Tennessee, Howard Cosell reporting.
It's a special gift for a guy to look like Cosell.
You're exactly right.
You don't bump into a lot of Cosell lookalikes.
You're exactly right. It's good to be here in the South.
Not yet.
Need the cigar, Ben.
That's right. You do need the cigar. That's exactly right. I knew there was something missing.
The big stogie.
I know what's not missing.
What's that?
A beverage.
Yes, you are exactly right. There are two things missing. And it is a clear liquid beverage.
Howard likes the toddy here in that, is what you're saying to me.
Watch your boots, Dennis.
There he is, the ladies' man himself. Jeff Fisher.
I think Fish's wife was a Rose Bowl.
She was princess. A princess, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Here's Del Greco to attempt a 38-yard field goal. And Del Greco, who is a scratch golfer in his spare time, puts that one through the uprights.
I tell you, he shot an even par round the day Wilt scored 100 in Hershey. Oh, no, that's when he was born. Sorry, I've got too many stats. I don't know. I've lost my mind here.
I lost mine about 4 years ago.
What? Were we in the sixth quarter here? What happened to this
Zandu,
place,
right? Two guys and a girl. You're going to see it.
Are you on
Friday.
The show?
I make a cameo this week on Two Guys and a Girl. It's Friday night at 8 Eastern.
What part did you play, Albino?
I can't reveal.
All right,
it.
I wouldn't want to tip it. You know, it's high drama. I'll be at home.
I do an in-depth interview.
Thank God I've got the TiVo. I can watch that, and then I can watch Vern Lundquist, I think, is on Homicide.
That one I have seen.
You know, I was wondering when he's going to earn his money, Al. You know, we finally get into a game. He gets a little bit away from us. Dennis, you're earning that big buck.
Hey, what about that second debate last week? Did you love that, huh? I couldn't watch the whole thing because I've only seen Weekend at Bernie's 19 times. Listening to those two debate, that's scintillating. It's like listening to Ben Stein read the story of O out loud.
And you get to reprise it on Wednesday. 7-yard line. Tyrone Stick. Back to the 44. So remember, if you win Ben Stein's money, you still have to pay the 39.6%, Dennis.
It's punitive, Al. I'm telling you. It's a police state.
Well, here's Mark Brunell.
And I'm not really sure why he's still in the ballgame with 3:25 to go. He wasn't in the ballgame at this point last week against Baltimore.
And there was no explanation for that till the following day.
You see the struggles that he and this offense has had the last couple of weeks.
Out of the shotgun. Hanging in there. Throws underneath to Freddie Taylor. He takes it to the 47. By the way, just to update, his pass rating just prior to that pass was 85 tonight, which isn't too bad, but, you know.
Well, listen, I like Coughlin. I don't want to get chippy with him. What do I know? I mean, he's got a mess on his hands down there. Seems like a strong character, though.
Very.
If I'd bet on anybody to hold it together, I'd bet on him. I hate to nip away at him up there. The guy's got some problems. I mean, that offensive line's in trouble. And I'm not sure if Buscelli's completely back yet, Al.
One of many problems they have right now.
Well, you talk about a great throw, throwing it away from Samari Roll. Beautiful.
Here's Taylor again. And now they'll go back to Jacksonville and hope to get Hardy Nickerson back next week. Hope to get Jimmy Smith back next week. Remember, Smith's been out since early in the first quarter tonight.
Well, looking at Thanksgiving Day present, Leon Searcy probably, but you got to hope they can circle the wagons and hold on till then.
Second down and nine is Brunell. Incomplete, intended for Kyle Brady.
Listen, it should have probably been a big rocket going off to everybody when Searcy got hurt. You could not lose an all-world caliber player like that. And, you know, you think of Jacksonville so confident, you think, well, they'll just overcome it. But there are some guys' losses you cannot overcome.
And I think for Brunell, it was the most devastating loss because, remember, Searcy's the right tackle. Brunell's left-handed. Searcy protects his blind side.
To a stop at the 31-yard line.
Glad to see him go down. If he got hurt in this time, that'd be you and cry.
Takes us to the two-minute warning. The Titans are 2 minutes away from their fifth win in a row.
Stick it in here.
critics have spoken.
Eccles is the best of all time on network TV at NFL play-by-play.
Dennis Miller brings a welcome dimension to the game.
Finally, the fan has a voice in the booth. There's little question. MNF is an event again.
Monday Night Football, it's powerful stuff.
Well, one Ernest Tubb opened this record shop in 1951 on Broadway here in Nashville. His store specialized in mail order sales of country and western. Jaguars offensive line, you can see the AFC Championship game last year to tonight. And not a single guy in the same spot. Of course, they were missing Pacelli because he was hurt. But Meester is a rookie. Smith replaces Wade. Stye for Weegar, who moves over to right tackle for the injured Searcy. And one of the reasons they've allowed the most sacks in the NFL.
And when you combine that with the injury on defense to Carnell Lake and Fred Taylor's injury early in the year, and then you look at the two wins that the Jags have gotten this year, one against Cincinnati and one against Cleveland. This team has the potential for imploding and having a disastrous year if they don't get it turned around in a big hurry.
And things don't get a lot better because on Sunday they go home, but they face the hot Washington Redskins,
who are just finding a way of winning ballgames.
The Jags are always good at beating the teams they should. You know, last year they were 14-0 against teams with 8-8 or less records. But they lost the two games to the team with a better record, Tennessee.
Plus one in the playoffs. Fourth down and four. Wow. And Mr. Kearse may have just given them a free first down.
He's getting his money worth tonight, Javon. You're going to go offside. Why not go around the Cape of Good Hope?
Offside. 90 defense, unabated towards the quarterback. The 5-yard penalty, resulting in a first down.
I think they should have more flowery calls like that. Unabated.
Unabated.
Unencumbered. Untethered. Mellifluous.
Sanguine.
Manny Sanguine. Loved him. Always swung at the first pitch.
From the 26. Taylor.
Ready?
And Taylor to the 7-yard line. Well, for some of our friends in the audience, this game is not quite over.
No, these people want their pound of flesh. They've never seen a loss here, have they, Al?
I'm not talking about that.
Oh, what I miss?
Never mind.
Probably their best offensive play has been a screen pass tonight. Fred Taylor getting down almost to the 5-yard line before Godfrey knocks him out of down. Not about
it. I'm just talking to a few friends around the country.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, touchdown be good for those friends, wouldn't it?
It might not help them, though, unless they went for a two-point conversion.
All of a sudden, I'm in the booth with the Robert De Niro character from Casino. What are you?
From, you're right.
Don't start the car up tonight.
You're getting warm. You're getting warm, Dennis. Second and goal. You had the right locale anyway.
Well, you know me, I'm a Nate. I don't know anything about that whole betting world. You grown-ups talk about the game. I'm going to go do the dishes.
You can get the hairdryer out on your way to the kitchen.
Oh, that's right, exactly. Let's start blow-drying Teddy Koppel's hair. This one's done. I think Teddy's gone to a windblown look since we started blowing. Very, very wispy.
Second and goal, Brunel. To the 2-yard line.
You got to like what Jamie Martin did this week. I saw them ask him about any potential for a quarterback controversy. And he reiterated twice. He said, I'm the backup. I'm number two. I thought it was a really stand-up thing for Martin to do. Brunell's got enough trouble, so don't need to worry about the guy coming up on his outside.
Third and goal. And into the end zone goes Anthony Johnson.
We got ourselves a football game, gentlemen.
Hello?
Huh? Oh, listen. Follow me. They go for the 8-point conversion, right? Is that rule no longer?
That's a shorter. That's when the ground could cause a fumble, Dennis.
And here comes Hollis in to tack on what will be the 40th point in the game.
You're a suspect to me.
Wow. This is getting heavy. Huh? This is like Robert Crawford. Gary Petrillo, you're a suspect to me. Is that beautiful? Just to watch crime prevention like this up close. Cops, Nashville.
And that's the voice of Bill Schuster, our umpire. And obviously he thought that somebody was about to commit a foul. Here's the touchdown run by Anthony Johnson as he takes it off the right side. Good job up front by that beleaguered offensive line. The center, Jeff Smith, getting out in front. Brendan Stye, and there is Johnson. So the Jaguars have a little bit of positive to build upon for next week's Redskin ballgame. Very little.
Well, I don't know. You think is this salvageable, Dan, this season for the Jets?
I don't think so. I think they're in trouble on offense. On defense, they're not able to stop the run. Eddie George killed them for 165 yards this game. They had a great game last week against Baltimore. But this Titan team is powerful. They know it, too.
All right, you're talking offense and defense in there. What about the internals, Ben? What do you sense there? You sense some dissension down there this week?
Well, I think any time you pull a quarterback, you're going to ask for some type of division among your football team. It was great to see the Jaguars support Mark Brudel tonight. It was great to see Mark refuse to come out of the game, play the entire game, played his heart out. But again, this team is in trouble.
Well, you got to wish the best for this kid. He's Dale's, and he's one of the nicest guys we've met on the road so far this year.
And a penalty on that extra point against the Jags. So
unsportsmanlike conduct was the call. So the Jaguars will kick off from the 15-yard line. Who would have thought on the 16th of October, when this game is over, the Jaguars will have the same record as the Cleveland Browns?
Not me.
2-5.
Maybe Carmen Policy.
White Clark does it either.
Wow, this is quite the little track meet over here.
Boom. Little onside kick attempt. And it is the Titans who come up with the football. Well, we told you about Mark Brunell, his benching last week. Here's what Tony Pacelli thought about what took place last Sunday night in Jacksonville.
The signal it sends is, you know, Mark's the problem. You know, he's the one messing up. When you look at game film, it's not any one guy. You know, obviously, you know, Mark would be the first one to tell you he needs to play better. We all do. There's balls being dropped. There's protections being blown. He's getting hit. I'm sure Fred says he'd like to run better. Offensively, it's all of us. We have so much talent in the way we're playing. It's not just one guy. So because of that, I thought it was unfair and unfortunate the way things panned out.
A couple of kneel downs will end the game. And the Jaguars, as you look at Pacelli, will go down to a fourth consecutive defeat for the first time since their initial year in the NFL, which was 1995.
Well, that's more of a comment on how brilliantly this expansion team's been run, that they haven't had a four-game losing streak since then. Most teams live their entire first couple years having nothing but four and more game losing streaks, but Coughlin's done such a great job. This is probably the nadir for the Jets.
And the Titans go on to the Beltway for the next couple of weeks. They go to Baltimore next Sunday, and then 2 weeks from tonight, Tennessee is back on Monday Night Football, and that is shaping up as one of our best games of the season as they go in to face the Washington Redskins. Coming up following this break, a look at the play of the game. Tennessee beats the Jaguars 27-13. Titans win it. They've now won five straight, 27-13 to the field in Melissa Stark.
All right, Al, Jeff, this is your fifth straight victory over the Jaguars. Why are you guys so successful against this team?
You know, Jacksonville's got a lot of people hurt right now. They lost Jimmy Smith in the game. That was, I think, a big factor. We changed some things we were doing defensively. We're able to get up, and you can't say enough about our ability to play here. We've got great fans. We've got a good thing going, and you know, they're struggling over there, but they're a good football team.
I know after talking to you yesterday, you were convinced that you were going to win this game, but did you know it would be so lopsided?
Well, you know, I was a little mad halftime because we've made some mistakes out there. It cost us some points, and, you know, you've got to take advantage of every opportunity you can. But fortunately for us now, this is three consecutive weeks where we've been able to roll up on our fingertips and roll off and run the football. We're playing good defense, and our defense hasn't been on the field very much, so it gets tougher now. We go on the road to two tough places at Baltimore, Washington, and we got Pittsburgh and Baltimore again, so it doesn't get any easier.
Tough stretch. Thanks. Congratulations, Coach. Let's go over to Eric with Steve McNair.
It seemed like the offense dominated their defense in every way.
Well, we wanted to come out here and show the Jaguars we can be physical then. We came out physical, and we knew it. If we kept wearing them down and making plays, our offense did not turn the ball over. It was going to be a running game effective with Eddie George in the fourth quarter.
A great game. Thanks. Thanks. Back to you guys.
Okay, Eric. Well, Eddie George is our Verizon Wireless play of the game as he carried 30 times tonight, including this one here, a 19-yard run, and that put Tennessee up by a score of 24-3. And Eddie tonight with 30 carries for 165 yards. Next week to the Meadowlands, the Jets and the Miami Dolphins. A reminder coming up next on the East Coast. Your late local news on the West Coast 2020 downtown. ABC Sports Online at ESPN.com. Keyword, Monday Night Football. For our crew, Al Michaels saying goodnight from Nashville, where the Titans beat the Jaguars 27-13. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, continuing the tradition of excellence.
ABC Sports thanks you for watching this presentation of the National Football League.